from Gillette Stadium in Foxborough, Massachusetts. It's the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. This afternoon, the Boston Bruins host the Montreal Canadiens. Festive atmosphere all throughout this area, and here in the stadium, it is a picturesque winter scene and a great day for some hockey. Incredible crowd expected as always, and an amazing atmosphere. At the home of the New England Patriots, Super Bowl champions, today it's the home of the NHL's premier regular season showcase, the Montreal Canadiens and the Boston Bruins, longtime rivals. We're ready to bring it to you right here. And the countdown is on for the drop of the puck in the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. Hi, everybody. Steve Mears, Dave Reed with you. Happy New Year to everyone, and thank you so much for joining us. Dave, this is unbelievable. Really already having a great time. You see the fans are very much into it. Warm-ups have just concluded, and we've got one of the sport's best rivalries on the center stage with this year's Winter Classic. Should be fantastic.
Oh, it will be fantastic, Steve. This is more than a hockey game. This is an event, and one of the largest events for the National Hockey League and for this area. This is just absolutely tremendous. The fans coming to Gillette Stadium to watch a hockey game. Normally, you're lucky to get 20,000 into a stadium to watch hockey into an arena, but here we're going to probably triple that easy. And they're going to be very entertained. A passionate crowd, this Boston Bruins fan. You can already see there's lots of black and gold jerseys sprinkled throughout the stands. I played for the Boston Bruins for parts of 11 seasons. And this was a phenomenal rivalry. When I played against the Montreal Canadiens, there was nothing better in the season than playing the Habs.
68,700 plus will be in attendance here at Gillette Stadium. Thought we'd look back at the history of the Winter Classic. This is the eighth Winter Classic. And we go back to the very first one, 2008. The Pittsburgh Penguins and the Buffalo Sabres that started this tradition. Ralph Wilson Stadium in Buffalo. 71,000 were in attendance. It was a physical game. Ryan Miller had the toque on. And the game would ultimately go to a shootout with the snow falling. You had that snow globe effect, Dave. This was a tremendous scene, and it started it all.
That's what you can see, the snow on the cameras as well, and Sidney Crosby with the shootout winner. Only fitting that Sidney Crosby in the original Pittsburgh Penguins baby blue jerseys. Remember watching those jerseys as a kid? They're still the best.
2009, Wrigley Field, going to one of the most historic sports venues in the United States, Wrigley Field in Chicago. The Blackhawks hosting the Detroit Red Wings on January 1st, 2009. Over 40,000 in attendance for this one on a 32-degree day. Remember that big hit, Brent Seabrook tossing Dan Cleary into the bench.
This was a great game. And Cristobal Huey was pulled for Nikolai Habibulin in this game. Martin Havlat with a goal and two assists for Chicago in the first period alone.
6-4 was the final score. Detroit Red Wings getting the win. 2010, again, historic ballpark. This was the first time the Bruins hosted one of these at Fenway Park, the Bruins and the Philadelphia Flyers. Some history between these two. And speaking of two of the most iconic figures in Flyers and Bruins history, Bobby Clark and Bobby Orr addressing the crowd, and they had the ceremonial puck drop. Really dramatic game, too. 38,000 in attendance. It was physical, as it usually is, between the Flyers and the Bruins. And ultimately, the game would be decided in overtime. So some Winter Classic history, and it was Bergeron to Sturm, and the Bruins won.
Marco Sturm, the OT winner. Tim Thomas was the winning goalie. Another low-scoring affair, not like the Detroit 6-4 win over Chicago in 2009, 2010. Some of the weather and the elements might have got to the guys a little bit as the game was a little closer, an overtime win.
2011, the home of the Pittsburgh Steelers, Heinz Field in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. It was a showdown of Alex Ovechkin, Sidney Crosby. Game was delayed due to some rain. It turned into a night game, was scheduled for the afternoon. Evgeny Malkin was scoring a breakaway, but Eric Fair was tremendous with two goals, 3-1 win for the Washington Capitals.
Semyon Varlamov was outstanding with the Washington Capitals. Now with the Colorado Avalanche, he had 32 saves on 33 shots for the win. Great atmosphere, over 68,000 people in attendance for the game.
50-degree day. I remember taking the coat off at the practice day.
You won't be doing that today, Steve. You're keeping it on today.
A little colder here today, January 1st, 2012. We go to Philadelphia at Citizens Bank Park, home of the Philadelphia Phillies. It was the Flyers and the New York Rangers. 46,000 in attendance. 41-degree day on this one. And the Rangers and the Flyers met. Ultimately, it will be the Rangers getting the win. Mike Rupp.
Two goals.
Yeah, right the slot.
Rupper with big two goals. This was a game the Flyers got up 2-0. It put a little scare into the Rangers, but eventually the Rangers came and would win this in the shootout. As you see, Daniel Briere not able to score. Henrik Lundqvist stopped. That was a penalty shot. That wasn't even the shootout. And this was John Tortorella coaching the New York Rangers at that time.
Rangers got the win. You'll notice the trend for the road teams, especially lately. You've seen a lot of road teams get victories in these outdoor games. And that was the case with the Rangers in 2012 as they defeated the Philadelphia Flyers. 2014, incredible scene at Michigan Stadium. The Big House, Detroit Red Wings, and Toronto Maple Leafs, 105,491 on a 13-degree day.
That was cold. I was at this game in full winter snow attire. My whole family was there. I played in the alumni game the day before, and this was an absolutely outstanding game. They were shoveling the snow off the ice in this game, and it was incredible how much snow they piled up at the end of the arena as they shoveled it. It was just snowing the whole day. There were many delays, but you know what? Look at the guys bundled up with all the headgear. What a fantastic day. Half the rink was, half the stadium was in blue for the Maple Leafs fans, the other half in red to see what was eventually a shootout winner by Tyler Bozak.
Red Wings tied it up in dramatic fashion, but the Leafs got the win there in the shootout, as you said, and at the Big House. It was Toronto over Detroit. And then last year, 2015, NHL Winter Classic, Nationals Park, home of the Washington Nationals, Chicago Blackhawks, and the Washington Capitals, 42,000 attendance, 43-degree day. And it would be the Washington Capitals, in this case the home team, and Eric Fehr loves the outdoor games, always seems to score.
All-time leader, that was his third goal. He had two goals in 2011 in Heinz Field as the Washington won 3-1, and his third goal in his two outdoor games. And this was a heartbreaker for the Chicago Blackhawks as Troy Brouwer scored with 12.9 seconds left to win this game.
Chicago Blackhawks was certainly making it interesting. Remember, there was a little bit of controversy toward the end on a penalty call. Here you see the puck sailing by Brayden Holtby. Love the jerseys too of the Washington Capitals. And they wanted this game. They talked about it, their owner, Ted Leonsis. As soon as he saw the first one, he said, we need to bring one of these to D.C. and was able to do that. Brandon Saad scoring a big goal for the Chicago Blackhawks, but ultimately the Washington Capitals would prevail, scoring late and getting the 3-2 win. Alex Ovechkin
looking for the penalty. I remember this. He shoots and the stick's broken. He's got his hands up looking for the penalty. He turns away from the play and the puck goes in, and that is eventually the game-winning goal. You can see the change of emotion at the end of the game. Love those jerseys for the Capitals and the Chicago Blackhawks. One of the best jerseys in the National Hockey League.
Fireworks were set off and the Washington Capitals got the win. So that brings us to today. And once again, Happy New Year to everyone. It is a 40-degree day.
There's Jeremy Roenick and Mike Milbury playing a little hockey.
Yeah.
I don't remember them being so cordial on the ice. I'm sure when one gets the puck, the other is either going to hit them, take a little body check. There's no way they're passing to each other.
As usual, they have that auxiliary rink, which is next to the main one. So some kids getting the chance, wearing the Canadians and Bruins sweaters. And how lucky are they? They get an opportunity to get on the ice. It seems like they're having a great time. Here's a look at the youth game that's going on. All part of the spectacle here of the Winter Classic. It started in 2008, and the tradition continues, and they have just gotten better and better year after year, Dave. And now we're looking at this showcase featuring maybe the best rivalry in the entire National Hockey League, the Boston Bruins and the Montreal Canadiens, and they bring it outdoors to the Winter Classic.
This is fantastic. Every one of these games, there's just something every the next year to top what was done the previous year. Just when you think there's no way it's getting any better, well, it does. Whether it's snow and the weather, whether it's the sun, whether it's the game itself, whether it's the outside festivities, whether it's the crowd, the venue, it just seems to get better and better.
Yeah, you mentioned Mike Milbury. He was behind the bench yesterday. He's back coaching. Your old coach, right?
Absolutely. My old coach, my old teammate. There's Guy Lafleur.
Montreal side.
The Hall of Famer.
The great Guy Lafleur, Chris Nyland. Ties to both organizations. The alumni game took place. They had 40,000 people here for first the women's game. There's Mike Milbury and Don Cherry, former Bruins coaches, as they serve behind the bench.
Derek Sanderson alongside. He made the pass to Bobby Orr for that picturesque Stanley Cup win. Mark Recchi.
And of course, you have to have number 77. And wearing the C, Raymond Bourque, back in Boston and on the ice and bringing it outdoors. So incredible intros, and this is actually a pretty high scoring game.
Reggie's got to have that. I'm sorry, Reggie Lemelin, former teammate. Remember Reggie brought those big white box pads in? Well, they didn't do much good in that. His legs aren't quite moving the same.
Alex Kovalev still can fire it. Still has the white skates.
That's not fair. There's a big age difference between Reggie and Alex.
2-0 Montreal. had the lead in the first period, but the Bruins would climb back the wrecking ball, Mark Recchi.
These young guys who could probably still play in the National Hockey League, Kovalev and Recchi, could still shoot the puck. He's a few years out. I don't think he's got the same level of shot as the last two.
He looked pretty good. And he had a big game, too. He saw the move on the breakaway. There's Mark Recchi again.
Guys are razzing Samsonov, but he's still the same. He's still not passing the puck, and he's still taking the shifts that are just a little too long.
Stop there.
That's not Patrick Waugh. You're thinking 33. That's Richard Sevigny going back a few years.
Marco Sturm, we showed you earlier, the hero at Fenway Park.
Quite comfortable scoring in the outdoor venue as he got the OT winner. That one wasn't OT, but either way, it's still a goal.
Steve Shutt
on Andrew Raycroft, rookie of the year in the National Hockey League when he was with the Boston Bruins. And
so it was 3-3 as Shutt tied it up, and then the deflection there. Samsonov again.
Could always score goals. Samsonov, Sturm, good players for the Boston Bruins.
They would call a penalty shot, and Donald Audette would skate on in and score to tie it up 4-4 late in the third period. We would go to the shootout. There's Samsonov, smooth. Still has the hands. Love the leg kick from Mark Recchi.
Okay, that's not fair. Richard Sevigny's a wee bit older than those two youngsters shooting. I bet he's got about 15 to 20 years on the shooters. Either way.
On dead again, and then for the game winner, fittingly.
There you go. Okay, that's age appropriate. Bork against Sevigny.
Chris Nyland had to keep it going. Tried the backhander, was denied by Andrew Raycroft. So the Boston Bruins get the victory in the alumni game yesterday. There's the celebration, and 5-4 was the final score. It goes to the shootout. Something Ray Bork never did. Shootout.
No, Ray wouldn't have been a shootout contestant.
So.
Although I would have put him in.
That's
you got to put him
would've
in.
Would have been a selection.
Like, you got to put Wayne Gretzky in.
Yes, 5-4 was the final score in the alumni game. As I said, 40,000 yesterday. An awesome atmosphere for both the women's game. The practice day was held, too, as they tested out. The players in both the Canadiens and the Boston Bruins tested everything out. And the countdown is on for the drop of the puck here this afternoon in Foxborough. Let's get you familiarized with the lineups for both of these squads and some changes for both teams, and the biggest one for the Montreal Canadiens, Dave, Brendan Gallagher is back after missing 17 games with a broken finger. He returns. He's going to be on the number one line with Thomas Plekanec and Max Pacioretty.
Yeah, Steve, big is an understatement when you talk about putting Brendan Gallagher in the lineup, and the key to putting him in the lineup is you're going to get your third line, that Fleischmann, Desharnais, and a Weiss line back together. That line was outstanding at the start of the season when Gallagher went down. All the lines really got shuffled around. Gallagher brings energy to this team. Pacioretty has really missed Brendan Gallagher on the right side with Thomas Plekanec in the middle. I would expect that line to have lots of jump in their step, but it will be interesting to see. Gallagher's coming off broken fingers. Very difficult to get back in the lineup, and he's coming back a little earlier than expected as well.
Yeah, Gallagher clearly with the padding on. We saw at the practice yesterday, a little extra pad on that glove of his. Here are the defensive pairs, Beaulieu with Subban, Markov with Petrie, and Alexei Yemelin paired with Mark Barberio. The starting goaltender is Mike Condon, Massachusetts native. He grew up about 20, 30 minutes away from Gillette Stadium. Big Patriots fan, and due to the injury to Carey Price, of course, Mike Condon gets the starting goal. He'll be backed up by newly acquired Ben Scribbins.
I like Condon's comments when he said, when I come to Gillette Stadium, I'm usually in the nosebleeds watching his favorite team, the New England Patriots, in the NFL. Now, he said it's going to be nice to be right down at game level.
I thought we'd take a look at some of these players, the Montreal Canadiens, as we look at Thomas Fleischmann, native of the Czech Republic and former second-round draft choice to the Detroit Red Wings. A lot of international experience. He played in the Olympics in 2010, a couple of world championships with the Czech Republic. So Thomas Fleischmann, surprisingly, having a really good season. And he's been a really nice fit for the Montreal Canadiens, hasn't he?
He has been. He's been on that third line with David Desharnais and Fleischmann and Weiss, who's on the right side, have been absolutely outstanding. And I think, as you said, it's surprising the goal production. This he has had a tremendous season, 8 goals in 39 games so far.
14 career goals for Thomas Plekanec in his career against the Boston Bruins, also native of the Czech Republic and a third-round pick of the Canadiens. He has been very durable in his career. 7 times he's played 80 games. 2-time Olympian. Thomas Plekanec, one of the more underrated centermen in the game.
Oh, very much so. 20-plus goals for 8 different seasons. He's in his 11th year in the National Hockey League. 13 years with the organization. A real veteran, real leader on the Montreal Canadiens.
And native of Russia, Andrei Markov, 15th year with the Canadiens. Dave, you and I were talking about how durable he's been and how solid Andre Markov's been on the blue line over the last 3 years for the Canadiens.
No question. The games that he's missed two games in the last 4 years, and that's coming off some serious injuries before that. A lot of questions around Andre Markov a few years ago as to whether or not they should sign him for 2 years. They went with the 3 years. Great decision. He's played 15 years with the Montreal Canadiens, but he also played 5 years in the KHL and in Russia, 21st year as a professional.
Turn our attention to the Boston Bruins. The Bruins with 20 wins on the season. This is the lineup that they will be sending out there to Gillette Stadium Ice. Louis Erickson with Patrice Bergeron and Seth Griffith, who's been called up from the American Hockey League. He's on the number one line on the right wing side. Bolesky, Spooner, and Connolly. Frank Vatrano, another Massachusetts native, playing with Landon Ferraro, and newly called up Alexander Kokhlachev. Ronaldo, Talbot, Hayes complete the fourth line.
Well, with Griffith in the lineup, that's because Brad Marchand's out for the 3-game suspension, as he was called last game. And he apologized to his teammates. He's apologized to the fans. He's a real spark plug for this team. You know, we talk about Brendan Gallagher. That's what someone like Brad Marchand brings to the Boston Bruins. As we have a look at their defense, Zdeno Chara, is he a force on the back end? Still a force on the back end for the Boston Bruins. Dennis Seidenberg along his side. Torrey Krug, keep an eye on Torrey Krug. Tremendous power play player, tremendous shot from the back end. As we round up with Tuukka Rask getting the start. Jonas Gustafsson backing Tuukka Rask up. And Tuukka Rask has been absolutely outstanding for the Boston Bruins as of late.
Tuukka Rask getting the call between the pipes, and a good mix there on defense with puck movers and some physical guys. Got some size and a couple of the more diminutive players, Krug being one of them. So solid Boston Bruins defense. Big reason why they've had a lot of success this year. A 20-12-4 campaign to this point. There is the captain, 6'9", Zdeno Chara, his 10th year wearing the C for the Boston Bruins. 3-time Olympian. He's played in 7 world championships. And as usual, wearing the C for Boston today.
Norris Trophy in 2009. And at those world championships, he's a 2-time silver medal winner in 2000 and also in 2012. Originally, Big Z was a 3rd-round draft pick of the New York Islanders in 1996. I think that's one of those players that you should have waited on a little longer if I was on the island.
From a Slovak to a Swede, it's Louis Erickson. 2nd-round pick of the Dallas Stars in 2003. 5-time member of Team Sweden at the World Championships. And Louis Erickson now coming into this game, entering this one. It's kind of been a tough start for him with the season. Now starting to pick it up a little bit because the Bruins have been playing so well. Big reason why, especially on the power play, Louis Erickson.
Huge. Louis Erickson is a goal scorer. He's a 20-goal scorer in the National Hockey League 5 times. 13 goals in 36 games this year. Like I said, he's been hot as of late.
And in his 9th season in the National Hockey League, Tuukka Rask gets the starting goal. Last 13 games, he's 9-2-2. Native of Finland and a bronze medal winner in 2014 in the Olympics. So it's Rask against Condon. That's your goaltending matchup today.
His last 8 starts, he's allowed 11 goals against. And that was including the 3 goals that Tuukka allowed in their last game. So in the other 7 starts that he's had, in 7 of his 8 starts, he's allowed 8 goals against. He is on fire for the Boston Bruins.
Rask 14-9-3 on the season, 2.41 goals against average. It is a nearly perfect hockey scene here. And now as we look above, with the fans filing in, we've got some cloud cover here. And in speaking with some of the ice crew, this is pretty much the perfect day that they were looking for. They wanted it to be cold, crisp, and have some cloud cover too. You don't want any sun shooting in here. Now, the word is that we could get some sun later on in the afternoon. But right now, these are, I would say, perfect conditions. Exactly what the NHL was looking for here.
No question. If you're skating outdoors, you want the sun. But if you're skating outdoors on this ice surface where there is the logos on the ice surface, the face-off dots, the goal crease, any color on the ice will attract the sun and will heat the ice and melt the ice. That's why the sun is not welcome in these games. But when you're skating outdoors, you absolutely want it when you're on a fresh pond for the pristine ice. But in this situation, a little bit of cloud cover, the other reason you don't want the sun is because the level of the sun and the angle can be in one of the goaltender's eyes, and that would create an unfair advantage.
That's right.
And that way, if we do see sun for a lengthy period of time, we may end up having a little stoppage until the sun goes in, believe it or not.
The band American Authors is performing right now, right next to the penalty boxes. And the players about to hit the ice here at Gillette Stadium. Now, you were at the one at the Big House, and you mentioned how the colors were 50-50 with the Toronto Maple Leafs fans and the Detroit Red Wings fans. What do you see as you look around here at Gillette Stadium with most of the fans getting to their seats right now?
I see a lot of black and gold, mainly gold hats.
Yeah.
Interesting situation when we were in the Big House in Michigan, being Detroit just across the border of Windsor, Ontario, and only about 3.5 hours from Toronto. So they pretty much split the crowd. If you were a Leaf fan, it was like you're on this side. If you're a Red Wing fan, you're on this side. And one side was blue, one side was red. It was a real interesting dynamic. Obviously, with the travel distance a little farther, going from Boston to Montreal, it's probably about a 6-hour car drive, and not as many Habs fans coming down. And if you live in this area, a lot of times you don't want to wear your, if you're a Habs fan, not that there are a lot of Habs fans down in the Boston area, most of them are related to someone who's played on the team, and that's why we're going to see much more black and gold in the stands. But you're seeing spatters of some red, some spatters of white, and those are the diehard Montreal fans in this fantastic rivalry.
Getting ready for the pregame introductions here at Gillette Stadium, home of the Super Bowl champion New England Patriots. Do see some red sprinkled in there. There's no question about that. And in walking around, you see a lot of Subban, Galchenyuk, Markov, Price jerseys. So the Canadian fans here, there is a presence here from the province of Quebec. But it, as you mentioned, it is a lot of black and gold. As you look around at the crowd here, the Montreal Canadiens and the Boston Bruins, so much history. This is the 910th. Meeting all time, the most in NHL history. Bruins founded in 1924, the Canadiens in 1917, beginning in the National Hockey League, and started as an organization even before that. 30 Stanley Cup championships combined. And they have met in 34 different playoff series. So you could really make a case that this is the best rivalry that we have ever seen on this Winter Classic stage. And there have been some great ones. Don't get me wrong. Pens, Caps, Maple Leafs, Red Wings. Of course, a lot of history. But here, both historically and present day, this is as good a rivalry as there is in hockey and maybe in all of sports. On top of it, talk about present day, first place in the Atlantic Division is on the line here today because these teams are separated by 1 point. The winner will take over first place in the Atlantic.
And that's really what these teams are looking at. All the history and everything of the rivalry and the history of the Winter Classic will go out the window for these guys when the puck is dropped, because they're concentrating. Bruins concentrating on getting to first. They still have to leapfrog the Florida Panthers in the Atlantic Division. And the Montreal Canadiens have had an absolutely horrendous December. They want to turn their season around, and this is where they think they can do it.
The Canadiens have lost 7 of their last 8 games, 11 of their last 13, and most recently coming off a loss against the Tampa Bay Lightning. There's a look at P.K. Subban, some of his teammates. Montreal Canadiens and the Boston Bruins, and we're ready for the pregame introductions here at Gillette Stadium.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. And now performing Duel of the Fates from Star Wars by John Williams, please welcome the Boston Pops under the direction of Chris Walden. And let's meet today's teams. First, the Montreal Canadiens. Thank you. and gentlemen, please welcome the Joint Armed Service Color Guard provided by your Boston area soldiers, Marines, sailors, airmen, Coast Guardsmen, and the Royal Canadian Air Force. Please rise. Here to perform the Canadian National Anthem is multi-platinum recording artist, Montreal's own Simple Plan. Are joined by the most recent winner of The Voice and Republic Records recording artist Jordan Smith for the singing of our national anthem.
So proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs burst.
Of the national anthem of the United States, Jordan Smith, Simple Plan performing O Canada, and musicians from the Boston Pops also with the music and the introductions. What a scene, Dave.
Oh,
great
fantastic.
Day for hockey.
It is.
Absolutely perfect.
Love it. Every time the Montreal Canadiens are announced, this crowd boos. This is a fantastic rivalry.
There is that hatred and
a mutual respect. That's the one good thing about rivalries, no matter where they are, what sport they're in, that the fans and the teams even always have that respect for each other, and that's what brings out the best in competition, is respecting your opponent and knowing that, you know what, I'm going to be better than you today, and that's what both of these teams are looking at. Both of these teams wanting to move up in the standings. This is going to be a great game right from the start.
players have hit the ice, and there's your starting goalie for the Montreal Canadiens, Mike Condon from Holliston, Massachusetts. 25 years old this season. He's 10-9-3, 2.48 goals against average, and a 904 save percentage. The 6'2" netminder will get ready in the crease off to our left. And Tuukka Rask gets the starting goal for the Boston Bruins. 6'3", 176 pounds. This is his 27th game of the year. He's 14-9-3, 28 years old, and from Finland. And in his ninth year in the National Hockey League.
Now, we saw earlier goaltender Andrew Raycroft in the alumni game. Well, Tuukka Rask was the first-round draft pick in 2005 of the Toronto Maple Leafs. And the Toronto Maple Leafs weren't 100% sure it was going to be Justin Poggi or Tuukka Rask. They traded Rask for Raycroft. Bad decision.
Wow, no kidding. Near your officials, referees Kevin Pollock, Wes McCauley, the linesman David Brisebois, and Steve Barton. Congratulations to those four gentlemen who have earned the opportunity to work this game, and all their families have made the trip here too. So the families and the officials, part of this family, a big part of this day and the celebration of the game. Happy New Year to everyone. And we are ready to go with the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic from Foxborough, Massachusetts, Gillette Stadium. The Bruins and the Canadiens, their 910th meeting all time. Fittingly, Zdeno Chara and Dennis Seidenberg begin on defense. Nathan Beaulieu and P.K. Subban on the Canadian defense. Off we go. Winter Classic is underway with a quick shoot-in around the glass. Brendan Gallagher is back after missing 17 games. We're at number 11 for the Montreal Canadiens. Patrice Bergeron, backhand chip out the center ice, hustling back into his own zone. Here's P.K. Subban. Will bang it off the glass. Nice cutoff throw by Bergeron. Bergeron trying to spin it in front. Unable to make the play, and it's lifted out the center. Pacioretty's lost his helmet. And it's dumped in by Dennis Seidenberg.
Max Pacioretty was the only player for Montreal Canadiens not to have a tooth on in warm-up. I'm not sure if he left his helmet on the bench at the start of the game because he had the same look. He lost it early in that shift with a scrum along the boards.
We are 37 seconds in. There's Nathan Beaulieu, the number one pair with P.K. Subban. And they're going to have to stay out here due to the icing call.
Nathan Beaulieu was a bronze medal winner in the 2012 Under-20 World Junior Championship, which is going on right now in Helsinki, Finland. It's the quarterfinal games to get going underway tomorrow. And Beaulieu has been a great addition. First-round draft pick in 2011 for the Montreal Canadiens. He can really skate. And they've got him now paired up with P.K. Subban, a spot that Andrei Markov and P.K. Subban were pretty much the staple on defense for the Montreal Canadiens for many years.
Well, Dave, big faceoff win there for the Canadiens, and they cleared it out quickly and got that defensive pair of Beaulieu Subban off the ice. There's Matt Pileski in the neutral zone. He'll sail it in, and it goes off the glove of Condon. Two players cancel out on the far side, and it's Alex Galchenyuk. He'll knock it out the center. Here comes a two-on-one now for Montreal. In with a wrist shot, and a save made by Rask. Good opportunity for Jeff Petrie jumping in.
Nice stop. Tuukka Rask just makes that look easy, the way he just snares it as he catches that puck. The Bruins get caught on a pinch. Big Adam McQuaid steps up on the pinch, and the puck pops out, and all of a sudden, it's a quick two-on-one. And unfortunately for the Montreal Canadiens, this is a defenseman, Jeff Petrie, stepping up. But Tuukka Rask snagged that very easily.
Rask will look on to his right. Tuukka Rask, bronze medal winner in the Olympics in 2014. Played in three World Junior Championships with Team Finland. Faceoff win, shot toward the goal, knocked out of the air, and scrambled for it, and score! David Desharnais able to find that puck behind Tuukka Rask and jam it in. The Canadiens have a 1-0 lead.
Tuukka Rask thought he had this puck, and then he realized he didn't. He wasn't really sure where it was. Now, he was looking to his right. David Desharnais came off the faceoff. David Desharnais takes the faceoff and just rolls out. You can see Tuukka Rask thinking that he's got it. Desharnais saw it, knew exactly where it was, and starts swinging at it out of the air. You see off the faceoff, Desharnais just goes to the net. Joe Morrow just can't get a handle out of them as the Bruins defensemen kind of get caught up with each other in front of the net. Joe Morrow loses sight of Desharnais and he bats it in. Good start for the Montreal Canadiens.
David Desharnais gets his eighth of the season. After the baseball swing there, we're in a football stadium, but the baseball swing got a little piece of that puck. And Joe Morrow, as you said, tried to keep that thing out, but couldn't do it. So a minute 14 seconds in, David Desharnais gives the Montreal Canadiens a 1-0 lead.
And then this all comes back. You look at the addition of Brendan Gallagher in the lineup. So this third line for the Canadians that we spoke about with Darren A in the middle with Fleischman and Dale Weiss, have been tremendous. And when they got broken up, the team, when Gallagher went out and the lines got juggled, the team really struggled. And early in this game, that third line that was so important to the Bruins with their 9-0 start this season, back together, getting the first goal.
Dale Weiss with 11 goals. All about that slotting, isn't it, Dave? When you have one player out and the rest of the lines get affected.
Coaches want to juggle the lines. They want to change things around. And Michel Therrien tried to keep that line together for as long as possible, but when they lost about 4 or 5 in a row, he started to juggle the lines, and he broke up what was the best line for the Montreal Canadiens. And now with Gallagher back, they can get his lines back intact that they had when they were 9-0 at the start of the season.
Corey Mitchell firing a shot that missed wide. Now Foliu and Subban again defensively with the Bruins recapture, and Corey Krug will move it corner to corner. Adam McQuaid off the boards, tipped by Alexander Kovalchev to center.
Montreal got away with one there.
And now completing the line change. And going for the dump and chase. Adam McQuaid defensively. Threw it back behind the cage. Kicked back out. Chopped that by Petrie. And now it's McQuaid defensively for Boston. Sent off the boards. Backhanded by Plekanec over to open space. Taking charge is Seth Griffin. And he will get the clear for Boston as they make a change behind the play. It's lobbed right in front. Trying to skate on in with Seth Griffin, but it trickles over to Condon. He'll put the clamp on it with 16:52 remaining in the first period. David Desharnais has given the Canadians a 1-0 lead.
Now there's Michel Therrien. He's keeping a close eye on his team. His team has really struggled. You talked about, Steve, at the start in the month of December. They'd like to get this new year off in the right direction. They had such a great start to the season. Things were so good. Then Carey Price goes down. Then Brendan Gallagher goes down. And the team just stopped scoring goals. Lapses defensively. And 2016 starts and started in a good way for the Canadiens. Now Michel Therrien's done a real nice job with changing the focus of the Montreal Canadiens in his tenure as head coach.
A lot of losses ever since they started the season 9-0. That great start that they had. The best, in fact, in their long history. The Montreal Canadiens began the season 9-0. The Price injury, the Gallagher injury, and it has been quite a reversal of fortunes, having lost 11 of their last 13 games. Dismal month of December for Montreal. A good start here today. Shot by Alex Galchenyuk was deadened off the stick. Griffith now steps up and he scampers out the center ice. Chips it ahead for Ryan Spooner. Knife off his stick and then he gets dropped down to the ice in front of the Canadian bench. Resetting his Barbario. Slides all the way down toward Tugarask and icing's called against the Canadians. 4 minutes and 2 seconds in.
Montreal Canadiens, Steve, a little bit quicker in this game. They're getting the Boston Bruins deep in their zone. Montreal Canadiens, Alexei Yemelin on the back end has, in his fifth year with the Montreal Canadiens, has been a blessing for this team. He's physical, very, very reliable on the back end. You don't see him a lot in the score sheet, but he's the guy who steps up, and he was the player who drove the Boston Bruins, and when he was here, Milan Lucic, absolutely crazy by his physical play.
Canadiens clearly with that speed here at the start. So you wonder about the road teams and the advantage. Something we touched on in the open. The road teams have definitely had the advantage in these outdoor games. They're 11-3-1 and have won 6 of the last 8 outdoor games since the start of the 2013-14 season. And that includes the stadium series games, not just the classics, of course. You wonder about the road teams maybe having an advantage because here at home there's so much extra stuff that goes on. Ticket requests, media requests, and so much more for the home team to deal with. And the road team has been able to come into these big events and perform very well.
You're absolutely right, Steve. And remember, this is still around the Christmas season, and this is the holiday season, and that is real, to me, very important why the record favors the road team. The home team has still got to worry about having extra family, extra friends around, and this is something that Claude Julien, who's played it in this game before, as the Boston Bruins beat the Philadelphia Flyers in a 2-1 game with Marco Sturm getting the overtime winner. And the home team really has to block everything out of their mind and really concentrate on the game at hand. And the road team can do that. They're in the day a couple days before, and they just have to worry about themselves. They're not worrying about their friends. They're not worried about the Christmas tree being taken down on January 1st or such things like that. And it's so much easier to play on the road when you're coming into big events such as these.
We got our first penalty of the day. It's going to be on Max Talbot. Delayed penalty call. Mike Condon has gone to the bench. The Bruins on the touch. And the Canadians will have the first power play chance of this Winter Classic.
It's a great opportunity for the Montreal Canadiens with this 1-0 lead to really put the Bruins back on their feet. And Max Talbot's been a pretty good penalty killer for the Boston Bruins in his tenure. Is not going to be able to kill this penalty as no question reaching in for the puck. He misses the puck and Nathan Beaulieu goes down when he steps on the stick of Max Talbot. Boston Bruins penalty killing has been pretty good as of late. 93% they've been clicking at. They've killed off 60 of 64.
And always a threat shorthanded. In fact, both of these teams can definitely score down by a man. Bruins win the faceoff, and it's cranked all the way down by Adam McQuaid. Talbot gets the penalty. Tripping is the minor, and 5:20 is the time. So the first power play chance of the day belonged to the Canadians. They're 14th in the NHL in power play percentage, 19.4%. 1-for-3 on Tuesday. Trying to get the power play going again to the rate where it was converting at the start of the season when they had that 9-0 run. Bouncing puck top of the zone. Subban down to the ice to keep it in for a second, but now skating ahead is Louis Erickson. Maybe a 2-on-1 with Bergeron. Bergeron trying to go back for Erickson. And ricochets over to the far side. Erickson now just rolls it all the way around. Back in front by Bergeron, but intercepted, and it's Subban with a tape-to-tape pass out the center ice. Canadians now marching on in. Back to the line. Subban winds, fires a shot, deflected, and it goes just wide. Redirected back to the top of the zone. Subban again. Big blast. This block in the slot by Dennis Seidenberg. Tipped across at the high slot. Galchenyuk for Pacioretty. Shoots one that's blocked. Kept alive again. Angle down toward the corner. Caught by Galchenyuk. He's got points in the last five games. Back to Subban. Slap shot save. Rebound in front. Pacioretty trying to stuff it in. And it trickles over to the backboard. Foot race forward to the half wall. Good keep by Subban. Gets upended, and the Bruins get the clear.
Boston Bruins did a real nice job at the start of this penalty kill of blocking shots, but when the shots did get through, Tuukka Rask, beautiful stop, but almost lost track of his rebound as he just got down on the short side under the glove. Canadians put some pretty good pressure on right in front of Tuukka Rask.
Wade on the hard around, 16 to go in the Talbot minor penalty. The Canadians leading it 1-0. Diagonal pass to the top. Jeff Petrie, slap pass down to the corner. Adam McQuaid, defensively with Zdeno Chara. Back comes to Petrie. Moved across, the wrist shot, a pad save made, and a rebound cleared. And that will do it. Talbot out of the box, and the Bruins able to dodge the bullet there. Back to 5-on-5 hockey. Jeff Petrie with the lead pass. The redirection into the zone by Brian Flynn. Punch right back out by the Bruins. Flynn again at the blue line. Lost control, and it's back to the Bruins defense. With the Habs leading at 1-0, David Desharnais, the goal scorer. And it's back at 1:14. Kick off the scoring here in the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. Bruins on the clear. Skating back. And regrouping, Mark Barberio. Tip in by Montreal native Torrey Mitchell, not quite. And we'll get the icing call against Montreal with 11:55 remaining in the first.
Excellent follow-up shift by the Montreal Canadiens after the Bruins had killed the penalty. It's key to keep the pressure on as we're going to have a look at Tuukka Rask on this power play. He's excellent job of tracking the puck, pressure in front. As Brendan Gallagher back into his normal position on the power play right in front of the opposing goaltender. And you can see how Rask goes side to side. Excellent movement while Tuukka Rask is down on the ice. And finally the puck gets jammed in tight and the last opportunity for the Bruins was with Gallagher batting away at it, but nice job by Tuukka Rask. Fortunately, with Tuukka Rask, he's got a few inches on Brendan Gallagher, so he can peek over the top. Doesn't necessarily always have to worry about looking over a 6'4" screen in front, but Gallagher's not afraid to put himself in that position and just get whacked away by the defenseman.
There's Gallagher at center ice right now, and he'll give chase into the Bruins zone, wearing number 11 for Montreal. You may have noticed the extra padding on that top hand for Brendan Gallagher, and that is the broken finger, a little extra padding. That's why he's missed the last 17 games, but he is back for the Winter Classic. The Canadians have a 1-0 lead. Canadians with the lead on a goal by David Desharnais as you look at Alexander Kokhlachev of the Boston Bruins.
I was just going to say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Alex Kokhlachev, the 22-year-old, has just been called up. He should actually send Brad Marchand a Christmas card thanking him for the suspension. That's why Kokhlachev's in the lineup. This is his ninth NHL game, and there's nothing more exciting to play. If not the Stanley Cup Final, I think the second biggest event in the National Hockey League is today's game, the Winter Classic. Kokhlachev was playing in Providence this season. He had 25 points in 22 games, 9 goals and 16 assists, and a very well-deserved call-up. And 22 years old, he'd like to make an impact in this game and get a chance to play one more and prove that he's capable of playing in the National Hockey League.
Kokhlachev so good for Team Russia for a couple years in the World Juniors. As the battle goes on, the net's been dislodged. Now Tory Krug going to mix it up right here. Tory Krug and David Desharnais. Jimmy Hayes will pull his man over as we see a little bit of the nastiness of this great rivalry. McQuaid and Weiss are barking at each other in the corner.
You cannot get near a goaltender without somebody taking offense to it. And that's exactly what Tory Krug pretty much let David Desharnais know, that you can't do that. These two guys are about the same size. Desharnais once again gets to the front of the net, and you can see Krug pushing him away from the net. He actually pushed him right into his goaltender, and David Desharnais didn't like that. You don't see Tory Krug or David Desharnais drop the gloves or get into situations like this because of their size, but when you're both in that 5'9" category, there's nothing wrong with letting each other know who's the tougher, who's the bigger opponent. But Tuukka Rask quite happy that his defenseman is trying to move Desharnais out. But Desharnais did a really nice job in that sequence of keeping his feet directed at Tuukka Rask. So if Tory Krug's going to push Desharnais out to the corner, he wouldn't allow that and end up going right into Tuukka Rask. Tuukka Rask had no problem once again. He's 6'3". Most goaltenders in the National Hockey League are in that 6'3", 6'4" category. Gives him a huge advantage to look over any screens.
So Krug and Desharnais will take a seat. We have had some nastiness over the years in the Winter Classic. Remember John Erskine and Mike Rupp dropping the gloves. That was back in Pittsburgh 2011 at Heinz Field. Had a scrap between, was it Dan Carcillo and Sean Thornton in the Fenway Park Winter Classic?
I think sometimes guys like to get in their name in the record book by getting in the scrap. I was in a fight in the Winter Classic. We're not going to see it that often because fighting is definitely moving, making its way out of the game. But in a rivalry such as this, it doesn't take much to set tempers off because these two teams have not liked each other for a long, long time. I played here in the early 80s, the mid-80s, and we didn't like each other back then. And these guys sure don't like each other now. You play exhibition games against each other. You play your regular season games against each other. And chances are really good you're going to run into each other in the playoffs, usually every other year, because these teams have always been in the same division.
Tyson called against the Boston Bruins. Bring it back to Tuukka Rask's zone. As you look at Andrei Markov, the veteran defenseman, he was a sixth-round pick back in 1998. What a tremendous career he has had. World Championship gold in 2008 with Team Russia. He's played in three Olympics with the Russians. And Andrei Markov having a tremendous year. Continues to get it done. Wrist shot on goal was tipped and stopped by Rask.
Andrei Markov has been an alternate captain 7 years with the Boston Bruins. That shows you the importance that Andrei Markov is to this team. Tuukka Rask, I like the way Tuukka Rask is moving in this game. He's really, really working to see the long shots. And you can tell when a goaltender's on his game that he's really fighting, really battling, looking through screens. And he's tall enough when he can't see over them. He's agile enough to get down low, look between the legs. Done a great job so far in this game.
Devin Miller, Boston number 86, gets into some traffic along the boards. Trying to work it up the wall, comes back to Joe Morrow. He gets belted into the back glass. Nice touch by Connolly, but it stays in the zone. And it's reversed all the way around. Come back to Blood, hustling over to the glass to keep it in. Didn't quite, though. Jeff Petrie, that puck just squared out the center. And an offside call against Montreal with 10:35 to go in the first period.
Alex Galchenyuk has been a tremendous addition to the Montreal Canadiens. Drafted third overall from the Sarnia Sting in the OHL in 2012. He's in his fourth year with the Montreal Canadiens. 9 goals so far this season. He had 20 last season. And what a tremendous young prospect. They've tried him. Put Galchenyuk in the middle this season. He's always played the wing, learning the defensive responsibilities of the National Hockey League, and this is a Well, this is the time that the Montreal Canadiens are expecting Alex Galchenyuk to step and take that next step and look for him to get that 30-goal plateau.
Galchenyuk's dad had a tremendous professional career. Alexander played in 3 world championships with Belarus, 7 years with Moscow Dynamo. And Alex Galchenyuk was born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
His father was playing with the IHL, the International Hockey League team, in Milwaukee at that time. He actually holds dual citizenship, but he's played internationally with Team USA, winning a World Junior, the U20 gold in 2013.
Here comes Seth Griffin up to the red line. He will chip it in. Mike Condon's going to elect to stay in the crease and allow Subban to play it. Now it's Plekanec off the dasher, and it sits for Beaulieu. Now it's grabbed and moved ahead by Brian Flynn. In for Montreal, trying to get the attack going here. Centering pass gets deflected over the corner. Hard down low is Torrey Mitchell. Getting back toward the front. Backhand pass by Flynn. Missed everybody in a white jersey. And it's Boston now on the counterattack. Barreling his way down the right side. He's landed Ferraro. Ferraro able to backhand it to the line. Quick shot toward the goal. It goes wide. Lively carom off the backboards. And now the Habs will lift it up and it'll go off the glass out of play. With 9:04 remaining first period, David Desharnais, the goal scorer, Montreal with a 1-0 lead at Gillette Stadium. Montreal with a 1-0 lead midway through period number one. It's been a while since we've had a prime scoring opportunity, a shot on goal, and Canadians winning a draw. Pushed ahead. Here's Dale Weiss, 11 goals on the season, got it in front. Thomas Plekanec now backhands it off the boards. It is Beaulieu dancing across the line, finding Subban. His slap shot is knocked down in front. Second try was stopped by Rask, and he finds the loose puck just ahead of the crease.
P.K. Subban wanted this puck for a while, and Nathan Beaulieu just did not realize that his teammate was on the far side. Look at Subban on the top of your screen. His stick is up. He wants the puck. Even though it's not a one-timer, he wants that puck. He gets that puck quickly to the net. Tuukka Rask, very sharp, staying low, being able to quickly pull in that shot from Dale Weiss.
What a year for Dale Weiss with the 11 goals. Had only 10 last year in 79 games.
It was a career high for Dale Weiss. I mean, he's only in his sixth year pro, and that's not all in the National Hockey League, but he's been a fantastic pickup when he was picked up from the Vancouver Canucks.
Attack continues from the Canadians. Petrie moves it along. It's Andre Markov, takes a hit from Brett Connolly, but wraps it in around the boards. It's back up high to Petrie. His slap shot goes off the backboard. Lars Eller behind the net, native of Denmark. Throws it into some traffic. Now the scramble on the high slot. Now stepping up will be Ryan Spooner. Protects the puck nicely over the red line. Tried to go for the pass to his right. That one just stood up. Canadians able to thwart that attack. And Alex Galchenyuk under some pressure here. Finesses it neatly over to Andre Markov, who slaps the puck out to center ice. Both teams make changes behind the play with 8 minutes to go in the first period. Spooner back in his own zone will reset.
Boston Bruins have really struggled after that first goal and then their power play by the Montreal Canadiens. The Bruins have really struggled to get anything across the Montreal Canadiens' blue line. The Montreal Canadiens carrying most of the play in this first period.
McQuaid's lead pass was tipped by Erickson. Subban back to track it down for Montreal. Norris Trophy winning defenseman, P.K. Subban, one of the best in the business. Going to Nathan Beaulieu. Now it is Gallagher trying to shovel it in. Couldn't do so onside. Canadiens now want a wholesale change. And the Bruins march ahead, 5 men strong. Deflection by Erickson, back into Canadian ice. Barbario sends it over to his D partner, and it'll be lifted to center ice. Back all the way down toward Tuukka Rask neighborhood. He'll take no chances. And he hangs on with 7:07 to go in period number one.
There's Lars Eller from Denmark. He was St. Louis' first round draft pick in 2007, 13th overall. He played one season. Actually played 7 games with the St. Louis Blues. His father, Olaf Eller, is at the World Junior Championship coaching Denmark in his second year, and they'll be playing in the quarterfinal against Russia, Lars Eller, when he came to the Montreal Canadiens, has been outstanding on the faceoffs. Excellent penalty killer. He teamed up with a young Alex Galchenyuk and Brendan Gallagher, and those three guys were kind of the kid line in Montreal for the first 2 years, and really generated some jump and step and for the Montreal Canadiens, and been a great addition. He's really settled in. Right now he's kind of second, third line center for the Boston Bruins.
Dad's done a nice job with that Denmark team.
Dad's done a fantastic job. Second
straight year going to the quarterfinals. They avoided relegation. Very scrappy team. Made it very interesting against the United States just yesterday. Getting ready for the quarterfinals. It'll be tomorrow at the World Juniors in Helsinki, Finland. And Olaf Eller, as Dave said, head coach of Team Denmark. We've had 10 minutes without a shot on goal, Dave. As you mentioned, a lot of the action's been off to our right with the Canadians owning the puck possession and the pressure. The Bruins, without the puck, having a lot of hits. They lead in hits 14-7 to this point.
That's usually a telltale sign of hits. It's usually when you don't have the puck, you'll have more hits. When you have the puck, you're usually not worrying about hitting the opposition. Montreal Canadiens have definitely had the puck more often.
Lars Eller steal from Joe Morrow's backhander went wide. Pinching in is Jeff Petrie. And the cycle continues here from the Canadiens. Here's Petrie. He's had a strong first period. Petrie lobs it off the stick and around the boards. Ricochets out the center and back to track it down as P.K. Subban once again. He pivots inside his own blue line. It is Subban here in the booth from the crowd here at Gillette Stadium. Landon Ferraro now sends that one into the open door on the bench, and we will step aside. David Desharnais, the goal scorer. Montreal with a 1-0 lead. Netminder Tuukka Rask with 9 saves to this point. It's 1-0 Montreal with the lead here in the Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. And Tuukka Rask is wearing a special mask, which he designed for this one since it's at Gillette Stadium, home of the New England Patriots. Got to have Tom Brady on the mask, right?
Absolutely, on the left side. And that's the old Boston Garden on the back of his mask. He's also got the mascot of the Patriots called Pat, and tight end Rob Gronkowski is on the right side, which we couldn't see. He's got the wide receiver Julian Edelman and the kicker Steven Gostkowski also on the mask, representing the Super Bowl champions New England Patriots, who play right here in this stadium. And it's pretty cool when these masks get put together. All goaltenders have got special masks for situations, and Tuukka Rask definitely showing a little appreciation of the New England Patriots there.
Yeah, a hometown team. Mike Condon doing the same. As we said earlier, a big Patriots fan at the other end. Very similar mask with a nod to the Patriots and their recent success. Rob Gronkowski, by the way, was here yesterday. Big hockey fan. Played a little hockey, too, when he was younger.
I could not imagine him on skates. If you don't know him, he's going, what, about 6'7" or so? He's got to be about 260 pounds, 270 pounds. I could not imagine him on skate. You think
Seriously.
Z's big? Z's 6'9"? This man is twice as thick as Zdeno Chara.
A wrist shot most recently there through traffic, and Tuukka Rask would make the save. There's Montreal native Torrey Mitchell. Been a big part of the grind line for the Montreal Canadiens this year.
Fantastic pickup, and Montreal has done a great job of picking up players. Played at the University of Vermont. He was captain in his senior year. He's really added to the depth.
Popped up in the air off the roof of the goal. And now lifted out by the Bruins. Hustling back. Trying to apply some pressure now. Louis Erickson along with Ryan Spooner. And Spooner number 51 getting bumped into the glass. Digging continues. Erickson loses his footing. Pops right back up. Griffith in there as well. Barbario wrapping up Erickson. Griffith takes a check. Around the boards it comes, and now the Bruins trying to get some forecheck going here and trying to build some attack. They have just 2 shots on goal in the game. It is Fleischman moving it over to the left side for Desharnais. A centering pass is deflected just wide. It trickles over the corner and followed up now by Fleischman. His wrist shot is stopped by Rask with bodies in front. Again, more shoving. Dale Weiss and McQuaid with some pushes there.
You can see the play, David Desharnais coming in. Dale Weiss driving the net. Thomas Fleischman, the third member of that line, staying high. Weiss carries the puck in down the far side. And you have good net drive by Weiss. That's what he does best. He gets in areas that are uncomfortable. Thomas Fleischman was pulling in as the shooter in the high area in the slot, but it was Weiss who drove the net. Got right in front of Tuukka Rask, almost tipped it in. This line has been very good once again for the Canadians. The only goal so far in the game, but David Desharnais is looking good, looking comfortable, centering those two guys in the third line.
Now it's the Bolesky-Connolly-Spooner line. Goes to work. Big hit behind the play by Matt Bolesky. Jeff Petrie now trying the home run pass. That's not going to connect. And an icing's called against the Canadians. 4:10 remaining in the first period. There's the veteran defenseman, Andre Markov.
Andre Markov was the recipient of the big hit by Matt Bolesky. Is Matt Bolesky trying to get this big crowd into some sort of excitement, as the Montreal Canadiens have done a fantastic job of stymieing anything that the Boston Bruins have tried to generate. Two shots on goal in just under 16 minutes for the Boston Bruins. Montreal, excellent job so far in the first period.
A lot of physicality from Boston. 18 hits to this point. Drive in on goal. Mike Condon catches that one. The whistle sounding again on an offside call. His play really grinds down here in the first period. Mike Condon grew up about 20, 30 minutes away from Foxborough, Massachusetts. Big Patriots fan. And on the back of that mask, on the back plate, it says, "Do your job." That's the Bill Belichick Patriots motto. So he said he grew up going to games here and has been frozen in this stadium many times, sitting way up in the nosebleed section. And what a story. Mike Condon has become Massachusetts native and getting opportunities as the number one goaltender and starting this game due to the injury to Carey Price.
Yep. His father was a state policeman, still is a state policeman in the area, and used to work security guard duty and in the overtime hours for the football games. And he came to this stadium many times to watch the Patriots play.
DK Subban goes hard off the boards back to center ice. A pickoff by Louis Erickson. Back to Subban. Gunned across to his D partner, Nathan Beaulieu. Back to PK Subban. Tape to tape. Pass and deflected in. Beaulieu and Gallagher in the redirection. The puck out of play. And one of the odd things about the outdoor games, anytime a puck goes out of play, it just kind of lands in the middle of nowhere. We're used to it going into the crowd and it becoming a souvenir, but out here, the stands a little further away.
It's really got a sale if you want to get it to the stands. You can see the size of the football stadium. There's all sorts of room around both sides of the arena. Most of the pucks in this game have gone out behind Tuukka Rask if they're going to go out. Boston Bruins just not able to generate anything so far in the first period.
It is certainly a festive atmosphere today. I mean, it's about 40 degrees Fahrenheit, roughly 3 degrees Celsius. Puck was lifted out of play. The Bruins claiming this should be a delay of game penalty. And it doesn't appear as if we're going to get one.
Well, the faceoff's coming outside. It may have actually gone off a Boston Bruin. As we have a look at the Montreal Canadiens bench. These benches are heated, by the way, in case anybody is wondering, even though it's not that cold, very comfortable for the players today. But there are heaters along the backside of those benches, so when you do get off and you sit down, then you've got a little warmth. Although, like I said, in today's game, I think the guys are quite happy. The heaters are probably turned down very low.
Anyway, the shot earlier, Claude Julien, the Bruins coach, looked like he had kind of the warm-up shirt on. He didn't have many layers, it appeared, over there at the bench.
Claude Julien's a pretty animated coach. He gets pretty excited. I think he warms himself up pretty good standing on the benches with his excitement levels.
Here's Jimmy Hayes with his checking line out here right now, and it is Landon Ferraro. At the moment, Ferraro with Zach Rinaldo and Jimmy Hayes, another Massachusetts native. Now the Canadians guilty of icing and yet another stoppage. So look at the head coach of the Boston Bruins, Claude Julien. There's the outfit. We were wondering about the outfit. That's always the question for the coaches, right? What's the headgear going to be? How many layers? Are they going to go old school? And I guess it's kind of almost football-like.
His assistant coach has got the jacket on with the leather sleeves, but Claude Julien deciding not to. He's in his ninth year in the NHL, as you see Michel Therrien. There's the classic, winter classic jacket with the leather sleeves. But Claude Julien is right now the longest tenured coach in the National Hockey League with the ninth year behind the bench of the Boston Bruins. He's in his second winter classic. And he is a very emotional coach. He played the game. He's a defenseman in his days. He had a very short stint in the National Hockey League. And he was an emotional player. I played against him in our early days. And you can see him pacing behind the bench. If he could pace up and down and they gave him more room, he would pace the whole game. He is an emotional coach. He gets involved in the game, such as his players do. He feels every hit and has the same emotion when his team scores or gets scored upon. So great players coach for the Boston Bruins.
Spooner, a centering pass, trying to find it was Bolesky. Top of the zone, it's Brett Connolly down low for Spooner. Catches it behind the net neatly. A centering pass, though, gets back into the crease, and Condon Sharp to cover up.
Well, the Boston Bruins the last few minutes have kind of slowed the pace down. We've had a couple of icings by the Montreal Canadiens, and that gives the Boston Bruins a better opportunity to play their pace. The Montreal Canadiens a little faster team than the Montreal that or the Bruins or Montreal a little faster, excuse me, than the Boston Bruins. And if the Bruins can slow the pace down and get Montreal out of their rhythm, I think it'll definitely be in their with their advantage. 15 minutes, the Boston Bruins have gone without a shot. Patrice Bergeron at 3:06 was the last time the Boston Bruins had a shot.
Montreal, the big face-off win here, and it is Petrie who flings it out the center ice. Brian Flynn on the dump in. Torrey Mitchell giving chase for Montreal. Takes a cross-check from Torrey Krug. Mitchell, a backhand centering pass, loose to the side of the crease, now tucked back in front. And the forecheck continues for Montreal. Back to the line. Petrie, a slap shot was blocked right in front. Now lifted up in the air, and that is going to be cleanly lifted out, and that will, in fact, be a penalty as Adam McQuaid sent that one airmail and right into the row of photographers and broadcasters right next to the penalty box.
And this is a result of the speed of the Montreal Canadiens down low. They're buzzing around the net. They're just absolutely outskating the Boston Bruins down low. And Adam McQuaid stops this shot, and he's thinking that he is sending this one to center ice. Kind of lost his bearings in his direction as he sent that one over the glass. And he knew what he was doing, but he did not want to put that over the glass. But give the Canadiens credit. They are moving well down low on the goal line. The Bruins have some big defensemen back there. And the Canadiens have some smaller forwards, and they realize if they can get their speed going, and there's the biggest of them all, and Zdeno Chara, and one of the smallest of the Canadiens forwards lined up against them in this power play.
So it's McQuaid.
Brendan Gallagher.
Delay of game, you know, watch out for Gallagher, parked right in front. Face off win by Montreal, and they'll spread out here on their second power play chance of the afternoon. Alex Galchenyuk gets the return pass now. Gallagher in the slot at the moment. It is Galchenyuk to the side of the crease. Pacioretty looking to spin it in front. Back to the corner. Pacioretty winds it all the way back. Swiped around the boards quickly by the Canadiens. Back into position. It's Galchenyuk saucering it across. Caught by Desharnais at the half boards. And straight away it's Subban. Angled over. A one-time try by Galchenyuk. He healed that one. And now holds on again. Galchenyuk going to take the pass off the wall, but a good read and tip out the center ice by Louis Erickson. 1:15 remaining in the power play chance, but 45 seconds to go in the period. That's the important clock, and it's Gallagher cranking it in. Whipped back down behind the net. The pickoff by Chara. Now it is Pacioretty down low. Circling to the top. Subban for Gallagher, or at least Galchenyuk. Reversing with Pacioretty. To the blue line for Subban. David Desharnais inching into the circle. Goes across the ring. Pacioretty's right there. Slap shot. Save made by Rask. And again, contact in front. And another scrum. Looks like everybody's going to calm down here with Zdeno Chara right in the middle of it.
Zdeno Chara at 6'9". He's got a full 12 inches on Brendan Gallagher. And Brendan Gallagher, watch this off the faceoff. Here's the size difference. Look at Gallagher. Doesn't stop. It's no penalty call, but Brendan Gallagher going right to the front of the net against Zdeno Chara. And at the end of the shift, it's Zdeno Chara flipping over and taking Brendan Gallagher down as the Canadians really trying to work the low play. You can see a nice little pull out by Pacioretty. Actually tried to go between the legs. It wasn't there, but Zdeno Chara, it doesn't matter, 5'9" or 6'9", he's got his hands full with Brendan Gallagher. You just wind him up and away he goes. With not playing in 17 games, Zdeno Chara will be chasing Brendan Gallagher all over this ice. Gallagher, lots of jump in this game.
Down to 5 seconds to go in the period. Puck dumped down by the Bruins, and they will go into the dressing room. Trailing by a goal after 20 minutes of play in the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. For the Montreal Canadiens, Dave, a lot of attack zone time there. They had two power play chances, and they will begin the second period on the power play for the first 27 seconds. David Desharnais, the goal.
And you can see Miller and Joe Morrow, Kevin Miller and Joe Morrow watching the puck, not picking up. Desharnais in front of the net as he bats it in. He's quite happy to have Thomas Fleischmann back on one side. and Dale Weiss on the other, as that line was very productive. And this was a regular occurrence. The Canadians putting pucks to the net, getting people to the net. Paul Byron, another smaller statured player for the Montreal Canadiens, but not afraid to get to the blue paint. You can see again David Dernay in front of the net. This time it's Tory Krug. The game plan for the Montreal Canadiens is get pucks to the net, get in front of Tuukka Rask, and put pucks to the net. Worked extremely well in the first period.
Tuukka Rask, 13 saves in period number one. So yeah, they peppered the Finnish netminder. Good save there. That was a redirection. He was able to find that one through some traffic. So Tuukka Rask has been very sharp. The physicality from the Boston Bruins in those 20 hits. You know Zach Rinaldo's going to be in the mix when you talk about that stat. And Rask was tested and coming up with some huge saves for the Boston Bruins. David Desharnais very much involved. A little bit of feistiness there. A couple of exchanges between McQuaid and Weiss in the opening frame. And don't forget, the Canadians still working with that power play chance with McQuaid off a delay of game. Still 27 seconds left in that minor penalty. So the Montreal Canadiens will begin the second period on the power play on the fresh ice. The officials have hit the ice and the fans getting settled back into their seats. Getting ready for the start of the second period. Nate Roos is performing. You hear the music there in the background. And the Montreal Canadiens, the Boston Bruins about to hit the ice. See that big red section there? Leads up to the suites. So there, the people in the suites wisely staying there in the intermission. And they will eventually, once that clock winds down, the fans there in the suites. There it is. Empty. Nobody.
Yes, they've gone home. They don't like what's happening.
Pretty much.
They've gone behind the glass.
A few hardy souls there still in the red seats in that suite level.
Montreal Canadiens staff coaching staff just making their way out of the runway as the Boston Bruins are making their way out toward the ice. Montreal Canadiens have yet come out, but you can see the fans, the excitement. They're staying warm, enjoying some New Year's Day beverages before they get out into the chilly weather.
Happy New Year to everyone. Thank you for joining us. And the Montreal Canadiens and the Boston Bruins continuing with their storied rivalry and bringing it outdoors for the first time. Two franchises have combined for 30 Stanley Cups, 34 different playoff series. 9 times they have played a 7-game playoff series. 9 different times the series has gone the distance. And for the longest time, Montreal dominated the history. They at one point won 18 straight playoff series. And the Bruins got the most recent laugh in 2011, beating the Canadiens on the way to the Stanley Cup, the most recent Stanley Cup championship between these two teams. Tuukka Rask, as we mentioned earlier, wearing the Patriots-themed mask for the Winter Classic today. And Dave got a response from the quarterback of the New England Patriots, Tom Brady, on Twitter.
I think this is fantastic.
Look,
Tom Brady on Facebook posts that he is going to come back. And he's thanked Tuukka Rask for posting this. And his post was, thanks, Tuukka, for featuring me on your mask today. In your honor, I'll be rocking your pads this Sunday in Miami. Happy New Year and go Bruins. Hashtag Winter Classic. That is phenomenal. Some great artwork going on. That's great.
Holding the football and the stick at the same time in that picture. Very impressive.
Tuukka Rask very busy in the first period. I'm sure he would much prefer to have the a little more time off in this period. And on that side of the mask, you might be able to get a look at. This was the right side of Tuukka Rask's mask, is where Rob Gronkowski is. He is the big tight end for the New England Patriots. And in this part of the world, he has got his own following. And he is the, I could almost say, a cult hero with the stature of Gronkowski. You can see him spiking the ball. That's him there, reaching up over his head. I mean, absolutely tremendous artwork on the goaltender's mask. And Tuukka Rask showing the appreciation of the fellow New England team, the New England Patriots.
After Gronkowski, the Patriots won the Super Bowl last year. They were honored at TD Garden prior to a Boston Bruins home game. And he spiked the puck. Gronkowski, right, at center ice?
And it bounced over the glass.
It wasn't just drop the puck. It wasn't even spiked. I mean, he smashed the thing. And the puck bounced up in the air, as Dave said. We are underway with the second period here again. Canadiens starting on the power play chance. A dozen seconds left in that second power play opportunity for Montreal. They're leading 1-0. Andre Markov, number 79 for the Canadiens, tried to feed in front. It's intercepted by Chara, lifted all the way down, and that should do it. McQuaid's going to step out of the box right now, and the Canadiens fall to 0-2 on the power play. Here comes PK Subban. confidently out through center ice. Tape to tape for Max Pacioretty. Centering pass, stick to the corner by Chara. Habs back on the attack with Pacioretty, their team captain and top scorer. The Canucks up high, Subban slap shot, never got through. Follow-up chance, angled over toward the corner.
There's your recipe for success for the Montreal Canadiens. Get the puck down below the goal line, really work the larger defenseman for the Boston Bruins. They're not as fleet of foot, and then take the puck from there, back to the point. Put your forwards from below the goal line to the front of the net and shoot the puck. Simple strategy in the first, worked very well. They're at it once again in the second.
It's Daniel Carr with a centering pass. Quick shot was stopped by Rask up against the far post. Valesky takes over for Boston. Wing-to-wing pass is too far ahead for Jimmy Hayes. Scrambled play in the neutral zone. Now emerging with it is Valesky and snaps a shot that smacks off the glass. Corey Krug on the follow-up, chops it down to the corner. Boston going to work on the attack. Misses the puck behind the goal was Hayes. Lars Eller takes over. Couldn't find a teammate as he turned around. Back to the line, and it's cranked up high on Mike Condon. And he's able to find that one. Faceoff coming up in the Canadian zone.
There's big Jimmy Hayes, 6'5", Dorchester, Massachusetts native, which is kind of a suburb of Boston, and grew up a big Boston Bruins fan. Went to Boston College, was an original draft pick of the Toronto Maple Leafs in 2008. Was part of the 2015 bronze medal team, U.S. team, at the World Championship. And played a big part of that, and is playing a big part of the Boston Bruins this season. 18 points and 8 goals. He's a big winger, tough guy to handle in the offensive zone.
Jimmy Hayes was a college player for the Winter Classic at Fenway, where they had a college game take place. Boston College, his school, played a game at Fenway Park, so he's a little familiar with the outdoor hockey and a big event like this. Back to the line, Yemelin's slap shot sails wide. Barbario down low, loose in front, score! And the Canadians again strike. Paul Byron at the top of the crease. Montreal with a 2-0 lead.
Once again, the Montreal Canadiens doing a great job down low below the goal line, and the puck gets back to the point. And the Montreal Canadiens just crashed the net. Tuukka Rask is not able to handle this rebound as it comes from low back to high. And then the puck is just back toward the net. The Canadiens are very good at this, taking the puck low to high. Little deflection. That deflection you saw right there allowed Byron to pick up that loose puck. Tuukka Rask couldn't handle the play on the deflection down low beside the net. And there's Byron banging it in. Deflection was Brian Flynn. Nice little stick work. His right shot just redirects that shot. It was going wide. Tuukka Rask had to move and respect Brian Flynn. And as he does that, the redirect bounces the puck out front. And Paul Byron with a wide open net.
Byron from Ottawa, Ontario, 26 years old. He's got his 6th goal of the season. You said a great play by Brian Flynn there. It looked like knocking that one out of the air and getting it in front so Byron could tuck it home. 2 minutes into the second period, it is 2-0 for the road team.
That goal is a perfect example of the way the Canadians work the puck low, doing it once again, and then get the puck back to the net and force the Boston Bruins to beat them. The Canadians forced to the back to the front of the net. They weren't able to do it as that puck went from one side to the other.
So Paul Byron makes it 2-0, and the Canadians looking for more. Flex over to the half boards. Beaulieu slaps it all the way back around. Comes to Subban, a drive, and it's off some shin pads in front. Second try is denied by Rask. Beaulieu for Subban, called for the puck, now takes it, slap pass. Right there's Wiese shot, that one's ricocheted wide. Subban again, one timer off traffic in front, got a penalty coming up. It's all Montreal right now. The touch, and we will have a minor penalty call. Landon Ferraro was decked in front, he's down on one knee.
Landon Ferraro might be just exhausted chasing the Montreal Canadiens around in their own zone. As we have a look, just the speed of the Montreal Canadiens. This is a look at the goal once again. It goes from low to high. Well, that's the missed shot. I'm sorry, that's Dale Weiss missing on the open side. We're going to see the penalty. Ferraro looking around, trying to find a man. Miller cross-checking everybody he can. Takes Weiss out, then takes Fleischman out.
Looks like Dale Weiss in some pain there, so Miller gets the call. 2:51 the time, third power play chance for the Montreal Canadiens. Canadiens 0-for-2 on the power play. They've had 3 shots so far. PK Subban is the quarterback. Subban. Vanessa's through center ice. And now we'll drop it up for Alex Galchenyuk. Galchenyuk with authority and over the line. Wrapping it around the boards, tipped by Chara. Bergeron able to find it, and he'll shovel it down. The puck wobbles on edge. Back toward Mike Condon. Thomas Plekanec will reset and hand it off for P.K. Subban. With 1:22 to go in the power play opportunity for the Montreal Canadiens. Here comes Galchenyuk, smoothly in over the line. Across for Pacioretty. Tap to the top for Subban, behind his back for Plekanec. Plekanec to the slot. One-timer Pacioretty, and it's deflected off the stick. Wrapped around the boards. Held in by Galchenyuk. Now for Subban, the one-timer looking for a stick in front. It thuds off the backboards. Attack continues for Montreal. Thomas Plekanec slides into the left point for Subban. Subban for Plekanec. Back to P.K. Subban, wristing it down low. Ricocheted up over to the boards. Kept alive by Galchenyuk, and it's Subban. Looking for the saucer pass, knocked out of the air by Landon Ferraro, and bounces out the center ice. Bruins want a break with Max Talbot and Landon Ferraro on a penalty killing effort. We told you earlier, the Bruins and the Canadiens for that matter, always a threat shorthanded. Boston with six shorthanded goals. That's third in the National Hockey League in that stat. We've got the players that can get it done. Down by a man, 18 seconds to go in the penalty to Kevin Miller. To the top, a one-time drive, stick saved by Rask. Pops up off the glass, Andre Markov now on the follow-up. Jumps on the puck behind the goal. It's Markov with a centering feed. Miss for Fleischman, trying to keep it alive was Desharnais. Lifted out the center, and now it's Spooner. Two on two for Boston, gears wide. Toss off the outside of the goal. Harmlessly, taken behind the net by Bolesky, and the power toward the front. He got stifled there on that attempt. We're back to 5-on-5 hockey. It's time that Miller has come to an end. Here comes David Desharnais for Montreal. The drop pass. Dale Weiss flicked the shot that went well wide. And it skips through some traffic in front of the Canadian bench back to center. With 14:41 to go, second period. It's 2-0 for the Canadiens.
Now the Boston. Seems like Boston Bruins really have to turn the page in this game, and they've got to get their feet moving. They've got to get the puck going forward. They've got to get their first and second man much closer to the puck and really try to generate some sort of forecheck, some sort of offensive push.
Here's Paul Byron, who scored 2 minutes into the period. Moving it over to the far side. This shot goes upstairs by Torrey Mitchell. Missed the target. Hustling after it now, Brett Connolly gets shoved into the glass. Patrice Bergeron looking to grab it. Connolly there as well, but it's touched neatly. Over to some traffic again, and then right in front, it'll be slapped off the glass and moved out to center.
Montreal Canadiens are doing a very nice job when there is any sort of pressure of good close puck support. They have a teammate very close, their outlets are easy, and it's easy exit out of the zone when the Bruins are able to apply pressure.
Get an icy call here against Boston with 13:41 to go in the second period. And the building silenced right now, Dave. The stadium is trying to get the energy going again. And Boston trying to pick it up, but not much.
No, there's really nothing to cheer for if you're a Boston Bruins fan. And the only thing you can cheer for is the play of Tuukka Rask, as we get a pretty good look at the stick skills of Alex Galchenyuk. He came in. He had a good opportunity to score. He came in the back door, wasn't able to receive the pass. On the last power play, Bruins did a nice job of killing the penalty off, really not allowing Montreal too many shots to the net and too many good scoring opportunities. But this game has been absolutely dominated by the Montreal Canadiens. Just much quicker, much better puck control, and excellent work in the offensive zone, and they're back at it right here.
Galchenyuk right in the middle of it, digging in the corner. We've got a penalty coming up, and we will tell you about it after the break. 13:17 to go, second period. 2-0, the Canadiens with the lead, and they'll be looking to add to it when we come back.
Lars Eller will be called for hooking as he sits in the box. He was chasing down Dennis Seidenberg as the puck went deep, and again, Montreal Canadiens just quick on the puck, and Eller trying to continue that. He reached in once, and I think there's where you get the hooking call as he went to lift the stick of Seidenberg, and eventually with the stick digging for the puck, takes Seidenberg down. And he's given the Boston Bruins now an opportunity to get themselves back in this game with a power play, and this crowd is starting to get a little excited as the music's ramping up, and they can feel that what we're talking about. If the Bruins can get something going here, get some momentum, possibly whether it's a goal or just some zone time, get something going and get themselves back in the game.
And Bergeron won the faceoff. It's back to Krug, who walks the line. First power play chance of the day for Boston. Seth Griffin Takes a look, looking for a play. Krug, point to point for Spooner. Spooner fires a shot, save made by Condon. Scramble in front and cleared by Montreal. Back through center ice. I've not said Mike Condon's name much here in the period. And you talk always about, this is indoors, goaltender getting cold. Well, literally, here outdoors, not much action for Mike Condon. He'll be tested here, though. First power play chance for Boston. The shoot in, it's Bergeron. Wrapping it around the board, sat on the dasher for a second. That allows Montreal to chip it out to center ice again on the clear.
Well, the one thing for the Bruins, we're what, about 7.5 minutes into the period, and they're going to have fresh ice in the Montreal zone if they get the puck down there, because they haven't been in their zone at all this period.
Griffith now in to apply some pressure. Boston spreading out on this power play opportunity. It's Erickson for Krug. Tory Krug fires one, and it's shrugged away by Condon. Foot race for it on the rebound, and chipping it out is Paul Byron. Sending it down the distance, and both teams will make some changes.
Now, Steve, that's two long shots from the point on this power play by the Boston Bruins. Both rebounds are kicked out well past the hash mark, and the Bruins just aren't able to recover any of the rebounds. One thing to get your point shots, get traffic in front, but you want to jump on those rebounds, and the Bruins aren't quick enough to jump on the loose puck. The Canadians with easy clears off 40. Of two rebounds.
At two times, one and done, and then in that case, he tried to enter the zone and couldn't do so. Now it's the big man, Zdeno Chara, to center ice for Bolesky. Connolly scampers in. Wants to whip it all the way around the boards and does. Comes over to Joe Morrow. Now for Chara. The one-timer pad save by Condon. Unsteadily makes that save. Now it's knocked in, but no goal. After the whistle, the puck hits the back of the net. Referee Kevin Pollock says face-off in the near circle. 24 to go in the power play chance.
Mike Condon does a very good job of making sure there is no rebound on this shot. This puck just glues to his right pad and stays under the pad. You can see afterwards the whistle definitely went. Whether it was a quick whistle or not, the puck stays under Condon's right pad. And you can see, you can't see where the puck is, so you can understand why the referee blew the whistle. Bolesky came in after the whistle was blown to bang the puck in. This is what the Boston Bruins need. I talked about not getting on the rebounds. There was no rebound there, but at least they're crashing the net and they're on the puck. And they were to the puck before the Montreal Canadiens. That's what they need to do as this period moves along. There's going to be a review of the play. I would suspect it would be to see if the whistle was blown before the puck went in the net. The only thing that can be reviewed is goaltender interference. There's definitely none of that. They can't review if the puck was loose. It's strictly, was the puck over the goal line before the whistle was blown? I don't believe it was. You can see there's the whistle up to the mouth. The whistle was blown before the puck was in the net, and we've got a faceoff to the left of Mike Condon.
Call on the ice confirmed, so we'll drop a glove side of Mike Condon. You saw Condon wearing the eye black. I wonder how some of these players will make the adjustment going with the eye black or tinted visor. Max Pacioretty going with the tinted visor today. Here's Subban across, short-handed attempt. He's shanked by Max Pacioretty. Thomas Perkanitz digging it out of some bodies in the near boards, and now sending it down, and the penalty just comes to an end. Lars Eller stepping out of the box, and Boston falls to 0-1 on the power play, trailing by a pair here at Gillette Stadium in Foxborough, Massachusetts. Hard check on Markov behind the goal. Boston, though, trying to get the attack going. Jimmy Hayes, Max Talbot, Zach Rinaldo, and now Bolesky. Energy line out here for Claude Julien. Bolesky scoops it over to some open space. Pinching it is Dennis Seidenberg. Seidenberg leaves it behind the goal for Talbot. Talbot tried to pass. That was blocked by Markov. Montreal sends it down. Icing washed out. And the Habs make a change on the go.
Well, there's an advantage of having no ceiling in a hockey game. You can flip that puck and alley-oop that puck as high as you want. You don't have to worry about it hitting
right.
The block. Everybody in there is wondering where it went. The Bruins were looking, and that puck was tossed way up in the air as the Montreal Canadiens made the clear after good pressure by the Bruins' fourth line. Matt Bolesky doing a great job in the offensive zone. And Brett Connolly gets injured on this play as he gets hit into the boards. You can see him grimacing in some pain. He went directly to the bench and didn't finish the shift. We'll have to keep an eye on that and see how Brett Connolly does throughout this game. He's getting some attention after he got over the bench by Don Del Negro, the head athletic therapist of the Boston Bruins.
Now behind the goal is Daniel Carr, number 43 for Montreal. Angled back to the line, Emelin, over for Barbario. Shoves it down into the left wing corner, and it's Galchenyuk. Locked up by Seidenberg. Galchenyuk with it, looks so confident right now. And a great season for Montreal. Slap shot straight away is sticked aside by Rask. And the puck goes out of play. With 9:55 remaining in the second period, the Montreal Canadiens leading by a pair.
Having a look at Montreal's defense, Mark Barberio and Alexei Yemelin. Yemelin's got one assist in this game. They've had lots of opportunities to shoot the puck, and I've said it a few times, Steve, that the Bruins or the Canadiens are working the puck low and getting the puck back for point shots. So you think, well, why don't the Bruins just cover the point? Well, if they do that, they're really leaving some of their slower-footed defensemen open and really vulnerable to get beat down low by the quicker Montreal Canadiens forwards, and you don't want that. So you bring your forwards down, you bring your wingers down to help out in that 5-on-3 situation for Boston down low, and that opens up opportunities for the Montreal Canadiens defense, and that's why we're like this. We're getting the point shots. As soon as those wingers of the Bruins start to creep down to help their defensemen in the low situation, the Montreal Canadiens are quickly throwing the puck back, and the Canadiens defense are putting it right back to the net, and Alexei Yemelin with another shot there. And the Habs, give them a lot of credit. They have executed this game plan perfectly. Dale Weiss took a cross check in the back, and this was the penalty by Miller earlier in the period. And Miller is, Weiss has left the game. As you can see, he's walked off. He's gone to the locker room. Long way to get to the locker room in this situation. If you're going for a quick adjustment, and in that one, I would have to say he's going to be maybe looking for some back repairs. He took a pretty hard cross check.
So keep an eye out on Dale Weiss, the second leading goal scorer of the Montreal Canadiens. Another penalty is coming up. This one will be against Montreal. It's touched behind the goal, and the Bruins go back to work on the power play.
No pushing and shoving after the whistle. It's going to be Nathan Beaulieu is the defenseman for the Montreal Canadiens who will be going off.
Hold the call against Nathan Beaulieu. We'll get a second look here as he was locked up with Louis Erickson skating down into the corner.
Louis Erickson just kept his feet moving down the boards, and when you keep your feet moving down the boards, you can't reach in if you're a defenseman. You really have to either use your stick on puck in that situation or just let the player stay wide and wait for him. Eventually the boards do run out and everything gets pushed back into the net. Eventually Beaulieu would have to wait for Erickson to come to the net, and Beaulieu probably felt that he was going to get beaten wide, and he reached in to take the penalty.
There's Torrey Krug, second power play chance of the day for Boston. They had two shots on their first opportunity earlier in the period. Ryan Spooner for Torrey Krug, fires a shot, sticked in front, Erickson looking forward, trickled to the high slot, and now nudged out the center ice. Carr trying to split the defense, takes a chop at Torrey Krug, and now it's sent down the right wing side. Krug couldn't make a play, trying to find a teammate. Montreal on the clear yet again. 1:30 to go, and the penalty to Nathan Beaulieu.
Real nice job. Paul Byron is listed at 5'8" at best, but he is extremely quick, very good in penalty kill situations. And if he gets a step on you and you're trying those D-to-D pass or he blocks a shot, good luck at catching up with him. Have a look at Louis Erickson. I haven't heard much of Louis Erickson was the one who drew the penalty, but we haven't heard much of either Louis Erickson or Patrice Bergeron in this game, and they definitely miss Brad Marchand on their right wing. He creates all sorts of energy, and he's out. This is the first of his three-game suspension, but with David Krejci, another player we haven't mentioned, out of the lineup with injury as well. Those are two players in Marchand and Krejci who are usually pretty predominant on the power play, and without those two, Bergeron and Louis Erickson being relied upon a lot more to create some offense. Just hasn't been there yet this game.
Couple quick passes. Bruins spread out on the power play chance. Spooner's shot is deflected by Erickson just wide of the far post. Almost right on cue, Dave, with Louis Erickson hovering around that crease right now. Trying to provide the screen in front of Mike Condon. Spooner's shot. Pad save. And the rebound kicks over to the corner. Hopped on by Griffith. Griffith up top for Torrey Krug. Spooner for Krug. Shot goes off the backboards. Griffith on the follow-up for Erickson. Five times in the World Championship for Team Sweden, Louis Erickson. On the power play here, but Montreal now on the clear, and it's 26 seconds now that are left. And the Nathan Beaulieu penalty for holding.
Louis Erickson so dangerous, not only with his quick release on his wrist shot, but also in front of the net with hand-eye coordination and deflecting puck. Just wasn't able to get one of those point shots on the deflection.
Joe Morrow now a slap shot, and that's cradled by Mike Condon. No traffic in front that time. Routine save for the Habs netminder. And we're down to 10 seconds remaining in the power play chance.
Well, that one was routine, but you can see Erickson in front looking for the deflections, and he's very good at doing just that, knocking the pucks redirecting them in opposite direction, and Condon has to be very sharp. He looks around, and that was the best opportunity. Louis Erickson just couldn't quite get enough of the blade. That's a very difficult deflection and redirect as the puck was going wide to kind of scoop that one around the goaltender, but Condon able to get there and shut that post off.
See number 14, Brett Connolly getting chased. Good to see him back out there after he was shaken up a little bit earlier. 1 second left, and it has been killed by the Canadians. Nathan Beaulieu out of the penalty box. Back to 5-on-5 hockey here. Montreal leading 2-0 on goals by Desharnais and Paul Byron. For the most part, have silenced this crowd here this afternoon. Good work with like effort to this point for Montreal. Here's P.K. Subban in his own zone. Finding Thomas Plekanec. Sausage all the way across to Max Pacioretty. Driving in. Now gets stood up along the half board. Shot comes in but wide of Rask. And ricochets back to center where Subban will track it down. Fades back into his own end. Crisp pass for Pacioretty. Montreal changing behind the play. The Habs enter with Pacioretty trying a backhand pass. But dribbled wide of Rask. Now behind the goal. Jousting is Dennis Seidenberg. Pacioretty in deep and following up is Gallagher. To the line. Barbario flinging it into some traffic in front. Second try. Looking to find it is Gallagher. Chopped up by Pacioretty, but it goes wide. Plekanec horseshoes it around the boards. It'll be missed by Petrie. He'll have to hustle back into his own zone. The Bruins now will make a change.
Once again, the Boston Bruins in their own zone. Very slow.
Carr with a step behind the defense. In with a backhander and a save made by Rask. Eller on the follow-up. Save again by Rask. It goes over to the corner. Tuukka Rask coming up huge yet again.
Bruins caught in a line change. Great quick up by the Montreal Canadiens to Carr to create that opportunity as the three Boston Bruins forwards exited the ice a little prematurely.
Alexander Kopitar trying to find in the slot, as is Landon Ferraro. Back to the line. Pumped wide to the corner. Lars Eller for Montreal. Under pressure from Zach Rinaldo. Kopitar. And now it's Eller for the Canadiens. Defensively, it's Yemelin for Montreal. Number 74. Steal by Zach Rinaldo. Drives around. Wraparound try. Save made by Condon. Keeping it top of zone. Krug. Slappers. Off a leg, dented and skipped wide of Mike Condon. And now it's flipped up and out of play on a deflection. We'll step aside. 2-0 Montreal, 5:15 remaining. Second period from Foxborough in the Winter Classic.
Steen Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic in Gillette Stadium. We get a look at the Montreal Canadiens once again. Brendan Gallagher back from a 17 games missing with a broken finger. Great opportunity. And then the speed of young Daniel Carr. It's a great scoring opportunity. Tuukka Rask has been very sharp throughout this game. And there's a look at Daniel Carr from Sherwood Park, Alberta, which is just in the Edmonton area. He played Union College 2014, won the NCAA championship. He got tremendous speed. He had the most goals amongst rookies in the American Hockey League last year with Hamilton, as he scored 24 in 76 games. Been very good for the Canadiens. Four goals in 12 games so far this year.
Speed, such a big part of their game, isn't it, Dave?
It really is. And you tag him up with Paul Byron. They're not big guys. Both guys, you know, Carr's 6 feet and Byron's about 5'8". These two guys really bring another level of quickness to the Montreal Canadiens game. And it's been very, very helpful, very productive. I mean, Carr kind of came in when Gallagher went down, and he has earned himself a spot in a regular position now. Sven Andrighetto was the player that sent down when Gallagher got brought back in. And Daniel Carr has become a National Hockey League.
Do you think it's the speed that's the reason the Canadiens have given the Bruins so much trouble over the last few years? They've been the nemesis. We know the rivalry, but it has been all Montreal. The venue hasn't really mattered. It's been a very one-sided rivalry the last few years.
And that's the one thing I look at the Canadiens compared to the Bruins. It's just strictly speed. Both teams have got good skill. They're very strong up front with their scoring lines, but on the back end, I give the Canadiens a little more jump on the speed department, and up front with the Bruins defense on the back end and the up front quickness of the Montreal Canadiens when the puck's deep, as we've seen all game in almost the full two periods. When the Canadiens get the puck deep below the goal lines, below the dots, the Bruins have to just pull back and wait to see what's going to happen, because they don't want to get engaged. They just don't have that same foot speed and quickness that the Canadiens forwards have. And that's today's game. You don't have to be 6'4" up front. You just need to be able to skate, have quickness and understanding of the game. And the Canadiens have done a great job of bringing players into the organization who have that ability, and they've really helped out their team.
Matt Pileski from the dot after some ferocious pressure leading to a turnover. Got a shot off, but it just trickles over to the side of the crease. Mike Condon will cover up. Jimmy Hayes there, Massachusetts native. 6'5", 26 years old. And we mentioned earlier, he played in the college game at Fenway Park.
Well, tell you put him along with Matt Pileski, and Pileski on the wing had 5 of the 20 hits of the Boston Bruins, and this great acquisition as a free agent signing. He played in Anaheim, had a great year last year with the Ducks.
In the slot, Hayes shoots one, Condon the save.
Both he, Pileski, and Hayes are big guys. They can really generate all sorts of havoc around the goal, and they both got pretty good hands for bigger guys.
It is Markov who hoists it back into Bruins real estate. Riding back in his own zone for a first-round pick of the Pittsburgh Penguins, Joe Morrow. Miller chops at the puck. Markov kept it alive momentarily, but now it's banked off the glass.
See how quickly how Paul Byron closed the gap on Joe Morrow as they were both skating back for that loose puck. Didn't allow Morrow to make a play. All he could do was rim it around and really not allow the Bruins an easy exit, and that's strictly from the speed of Paul Byron on the forecheck.
The shots are 24-14 in favor of Montreal. Montreal again on the dump and chase. Pounded off the glass. And Pacioretty lost his footing. Ryan Spooner recovers for Boston. And Spooner angling one to the top of the zone. That's kept in, and Pacioretty's got it now. Chips it over to the far side for Thomas Plekanec. Plekanec across the rink, Pacioretty getting it on goal, and now it's knocked in out of the air. And it's Brendan Gallagher who's back for Montreal. He's given the Canadiens a 3-0 lead.
Well, this was an ill-advised pass that started this sequence for the Montreal Canadiens. Ryan Spooner had the puck low, and he tried a cross-ice pass that he probably shouldn't have done, and then the Montreal Canadiens get the puck, and you can see the lateral movement and a little baseball play. It's almost like lacrosse when the puck's not even on the ice. It comes from the corner out to the front, and Gallagher is just going to bat this puck out of the air. You see Pacioretty takes it out of the air on the pass to Gallagher, and then Gallagher takes it out of the air to bat it into the net. Great hand-eye coordination. That's more of a lacrosse play than a hockey play. I can't remember because the last time I saw a pass to a player who bats the pass out of the air and then the shot is batted out of the air for a goal. And Brendan Gallagher, boy, he's happy with that one. 17 games out of the lineup. He watched his team struggle terribly while he was out of the lineup, and then he comes back and he scores the third goal of the game for his team.
Such a valuable part of this team. Brendan Gallagher returning after missing 17 games with a broken finger. And as documented on the Epics Road to the Winter Classic series, it was a frustrating time for him. Wasn't really able to work out as much as he would like, even though it was a hand injury. But Brendan Gallagher back, a little extra padding on that top hand with his glove, just in order to play in this game. It was cleared by the doctors, but he said this was the goal. He wanted to be here. He wanted to play in this game and make his return today in Foxborough. And not only has he returned, he's now scored the third goal and given the Montreal Canadiens a 3-0 advantage. Pacioretty and Plekanec, his line mates, get the assist. And the crowd here stunned. 68,000 plus in attendance. Boston trying to answer with Kopitar centering pass, but Toronto flicked that one wide. And now it's Nathan Beaulieu meandering through center ice. Boston changed behind the play. Kopitar now takes it, steps in, rather Bergeron, a wrist shot, and stopped by Condon.
Condon way up top of the blue paint, not much to shoot at for Bergeron.
Erickson in front for Bergeron, and play stops yet again.
The net was lifted up, I'm not sure if it came off the moorings, but the net came right up almost on top of Condon's back. And the referee down below the goal line saw it, probably saw it out of the corner of his eyes, he was watching the puck and blew the whistle immediately. As you have a look at Brendan Gallagher, I mean, you just compare the team with Brendan Gallagher at the start of the season, 16-4-2, 3.55 goals for per game, and without Brendan Gallagher, those 17 games, 5-11-1, their goals for per game, 1.82. I mean, what a difference one player can make in the makeup of a team, and he is that the Energizer Bunny, they call him. He just wind him up and let him go. He has nonstop energy for the Canadiens, and he's brought the excitement back to the team, and you can see when he scores the goal. Doesn't need his hands, doesn't need the finger to shoot the puck when he can bat it in like that, but he's a huge part of this team. A couple years ago when he came onto the scene in Montreal, didn't matter what line he was on, that line was the top line. And that's why Gallagher went pretty much from a fourth line player to a first line player in about a year and a half, because he just made other players better. And that's what he does with Plekanec and Pacioretty. They're better players with Brendan Gallagher.
Hard to believe he was a fifth round pick, Brendan Gallagher. He's only 5'9" though, the fifth round pick 2010.
That's why, and it's unfair.
See the energy, and he plays like he's 7 feet tall. The guy just so much energy and fearless too. A big part of the identity. Panitz knocks this one out of the air with another swing at the puck. And now the discussion. That appeared to be a penalty, Dave.
It is a penalty. It was directed right over the glass. It didn't touch the glass. It didn't touch anything else. And this is going to be a delay of game penalty. Thomas Plekanec. The puck pops off the glass as Krug puts it in, and the Montreal Canadiens are showing some pretty good baseball skills. This is the third player in about 3 minutes to take the puck out of the air, and I'm not really sure what Plekanec was thinking, because he's got to understand that if he doesn't get all of the puck, he doesn't hit to where he wants it to, it's going to sail over the glass like it did. And that's an easy call. But the Bruins are up three with 29.5 seconds remaining in the second period. They want to get out of this period with a 3-goal lead.
You would think we were at Fenway, right?
We had that play.
You had two on the goal by Gallagher and the Desharnais play in the first period out of midair. So 25 seconds to go in the second period. Boston would love a goal here. Shot in the slot was blocked. Subban shaken up. He'll slowly go to the bench in some pain. Montreal got the clear. We're down to 15 seconds to go in the middle frame. Krug leads the charge. Spooner shovels it in. Condon leaving it for Subban, who stayed out there, tried to pound it around the boards. It was cut off. Pass across, Spooner's right there. He's robbed by Condon. What a save. Oh, what a stop by the Canadiens netminder, Mike Condon, with the save of the day.
Absolutely. We haven't said Mike Condon's name on big saves in this game, but this is one that keeps the zero on the board for the Canadiens. Ryan Spooner gets it, just a little too much time, which allows Condon to move over, but give Condon all the credit in the world here. He comes up and he just throws the glove up and takes that puck, which was headed to the top corner. If Ryan Spooner can get that puck away a slight, maybe half second quicker, he may have the top of the net. But Condon, the save of the game so far for the Montreal Canadiens.
With 1/10 of a second left in the period, Mike Condon comes up with his biggest stop. Glove save on Ryan Spooner at the power play chance. 17 saves to this point. And Mike Condon will head to the dressing room with a fairly comfortable 3-0 lead through 40 minutes of play in the 2016 Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic. Some congratulations there from his teammates. And again, the players will go just off to the side of the ice, get the skate guards on because of the long walk down the runway and then over into the respective dressing rooms. But Paul Byron and Brendan Gallagher scoring goals, and the Montreal Canadiens have a 3-0 lead, Dave. But
this is not the same Montreal Canadiens team that we saw the past month. And we have been praising Brendan Gallagher throughout the game, and especially since he scored that goal. And this is a completely different team. It's as though they found their ways, the way they were playing at the start of the season when they were dominant. They were skating, they're quick on pucks, they're crashing the net. Their defense are very crisp in getting the puck quickly to the net. It's been a fantastic performance through two periods for the Montreal Canadiens.
Think of the enormity of that save. That puck goes in, Boston's able to score in the final second. Think of the energy they have going into the dressing room. They've cut it to 2 goals, but Mike Condon comes up with a gigantic save, and your score is 3-0. The Canadiens with the lead. Desharnais, Byron, and Gallagher, the goal scorers, and we're pleased to be joined by Canadiens forward Lars Eller at ringside. Lars, got to start off. What do you think of that last second save from your goaltender there?
That was huge for us. Not letting them get a goal here before the second. Huge save by Condo there.
Lars, I'm going to switch things a little bit from today's game to the World Junior Championship. Your father is over there. Your brother played in the tournament last year. How much are you enjoying Denmark's performance once again in this year's World Junior Championship?
I know they've done great. Won their first game in regulation ever and made it to the quarters 2 years in a row. It's a big step for them, and for that program, they come a long way in a very short time.
Yeah, really impressive. We've been impressed by the junior team, but overall, give us an idea of hockey in Denmark and the growth of the game, because we're seeing them, the players like yourself, on the world stage here.
Yeah, the last 4 or 5 years, we got a handful of young guys coming into the NHL and really establishing themselves. You know, the national teams are doing well now too, and you know, there's more rinks starting to pop up, and you know, we got the world championships there in 2 years as well. So there's a lot of good things happening for hockey in Denmark.
Lars, a fantastic two periods for your team. What are the changes that you guys have made coming into this game and kind of putting December in your rearview mirror? You guys have been fantastic through two periods.
Yeah, I don't know. We always seem to play some of our best hockey against the Bruins for some reason. And, you know, today there's a lot of motivation, a lot of energy in the room, and we got Gallagher back. That certainly helps. So just a lot of things going our way today.
Lars, best of luck in the third period. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Lars Eller, native of Denmark. His team up 3-0 after 40 minutes of play. The kids getting ready to hit the ice again. And Byron and Gallagher scoring in the second. Montreal with the lead. Much more coming up. Stay with us. And you see the power plays as well with Montreal 0-3. Boston currently working on their second chance. They'll begin the third period on the power play for the first minute 31 seconds. But again, if you're Michel Therrien, still pretty happy in the second intermission, aren't you, Dave?
Absolutely, as we see the scorers, and it's Paul Byron who got his sixth of the year. What a great pickup he has been, a waiver pickup by the Montreal Canadiens. And Brendan Gallagher, back from a 17-game hiatus with an injury with broken finger in his hand, he gets his 10th of the season from Max Pacioretty and Thomas Plekanec in a great period for the Montreal Canadiens once again. And Mike Condon absolutely outstanding late in the period with that save off of Ryan Spooner's shot to keep it at 3-0.
Time for the second period highlights. Canadiens got off to a good start, challenging Tuukka Rask. And then finally, a little hard work paid off. Paul Byron is sixth of the season from Flynn and Barbario. Crashing the crease. Not pretty, but they'll take it.
Absolutely, the speed of the Montreal Canadiens. Real nice little redirect by Brian Flynn to keep that play alive as it is deflected out in front. And Dale Weiss gets injured on this play. He takes a cross check from behind and jams his hand. Watch, he gets up and he shakes his hand. He eventually left the second period as he walked back to the locker room. Interesting to see if we see him in the third period. Big part of the Montreal Canadiens' energy that they bring. And here's Brian Connor working some magic on the Bruins' power play, making some of his best stops. And that Louis Erickson redirect just hits the outside of the net. Tuukka Rask once again at his best, battling to see the pucks. And here's some of the speed that we see of the Montreal Canadiens and a couple of defensemen. Kevin Miller is one defenseman for the Boston Bruins on the back end, and Joe Morrow have just not been able to keep up with the speed of the Montreal Canadiens. You can see again Miller and Morrow on the ice. Brendan Gallagher banging this one in. You're not going to see this very often. Pacioretty deflects it up to himself, knocks the out of the air as a pass, and then Gallagher takes it out of the air and slaps it in behind Tuukka Rask.
And the save of the day on Ryan Spooner in the final second, literally 0.1 seconds remaining in the second period, and Mike Condon flashes out the glove, and the Patriots fan and Massachusetts native makes his biggest stop. To this point, he has made 17 saves, and the Montreal Canadiens leading 3-0. The player's about to hit the ice. The word from Montreal is that Dale Weiss will not return. He's their second leading goal scorer and has had an unbelievable season. Dale Weiss with the 11 goals and 20 points. So Weiss, because of that cross check and what appeared to be in favoring his wrist or hand, Weiss won't be back.
Originally, I thought it may have been a back injury, the way he was cross-checked. There was a penalty on the play, but for the Montreal Canadiens, it's a little frustrating. Yeah, you're up 3-0. You're outplaying your opposition, and when it's Boston, that's always a good thing when you're a Canadiens fan. But for them to lose Dale Weiss, the day and the game that they get Brendan Gallagher back, and these two players are so significant to this team. Gallagher brings the energy. Dale Weiss has really solidified that third line. He's played with David Desharnais most of the season, and on the other side, it's Thomas Fleischmann, and that line brings energy, brings a consistency to the game, and Weiss is that one player who is always in the opposition's face, gets under the skin, really picks his team up when things aren't going well, and much like a Brendan Gallagher. So hopefully it's not a injury that will keep Dale Weiss out of the lineup for a long time, but it's definitely a player that the Montreal Canadiens don't want to lose. He brings a lot inside the locker room as much as he does on the ice.
Boston Bruins have hit the ice. The Canadiens getting there as they make the long walk over to the ice surface here at Gillette Stadium. I love the jerseys on both sides, especially there with Montreal with the logo and the jersey pretty much inspired by the first jersey they ever wore back in 1909. Really sharp. Brennan Gallagher stepping out up to the platform and take the skate guards off, we hope. Hit the ice.
That would be dangerous. I am a little biased when it comes to the jerseys of original six teams, Montreal Canadiens, Boston Bruins being two of them, and the classic look. And this is, it's a little change, but it's still a classic look. And the Boston Bruins, that black and gold look with the bear in the middle of the jersey.
Boston Bruins wearing the uniforms very similar to the first jersey they ever wore, their inaugural season, 1924-25.
Now, I don't mean to be biased on these broadcasts, but I would like to see the Bruins score for one reason. I would like to see this crowd.
You want the
erupt.
Crowd, yeah.
Oh, there's 60,000 plus people here. You want to see the excitement and see how loud this building can get. And that's the fun of it. I remember being in Detroit at the Big House when the Red Wings took on the Leafs a few years ago, and everybody, and it was a wintry day, very cold, the wind was blowing, and everybody were sitting with the alumni going, please, someone score a goal, because we didn't care who scored, we just wanted to hear the stadium erupt. Very rarely do you get to come to a stadium in the situation of a hockey game such as this, and you want to see that home team score one and listen to the crowd. Montreal Canadiens, on the other hand, could care less about that.
For sure. We are underway. Canadiens shorthanded to begin the third period. P.K. Subban takes the handoff from his goaltender, cranks it around the glass. It's back to the Bruin defense. Over 68,000 in attendance here, a packed stadium. And weather-wise, really a perfect hockey day. 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Look at the moves by Spooner. Cutting down the middle with a backhander. He missed it low and wide. Then back to the top, and it's Torrey Krug. His pocket picked, and the puck cleared. Goes down the distance, courtesy of Paul Byron.
Ryan Spooner, great opportunity at the end of the second period, and robbed by Mike Condon, and another great opportunity right there. I don't think he realized it or expected to get through the Canadiens' penalty killing so easily, and he ended up right on top of Condon on the back end and didn't get much of a shot, but fantastic moves by the young Bruin forward skating through the middle of the ice.
It's Torrey Krug, and the Bruins moving right to left with 30 seconds remaining in their third power play chance of the afternoon. Matt Valesky behind the goal. Valesky couldn't dig it out. Canadiens and the backhander by Flynn. Another clear, and the fans getting frustrated. 15 seconds left, and a very important power play chance for Boston. But they came oh so close in that prime scoring chance in the final second for Ryan Spooner, and the glove save made by Mike Condon. 3 seconds left in the power play opportunity. Chara down to the right side. The wrist shot by Hayes. Stopped by Condon. Back to the front by Morrow, but cleaned up by Andre Markov. Chopped that by Pacioretty. And now Markov will throw it back to P.K. Subban, who pivots behind Condon. We're back to 5-on-5 hockey. It is P.K. Subban, Norris Trophy winning defenseman. Confidently circles around. Here's the booze from the crowd. Not a fan favorite, the state of Massachusetts, P.K. Subban.
You know what? It's always a good thing when you are a star of the opposition to get booed in their rink.
It's
a show of respect, believe it or not, that the visiting crowd dislikes you so much, because usually you've done some things that have defeated the home crowd, and that's what P.K. Subban has done here for the Boston Bruin fans.
Gallagher whacks it out the center ice. Puck was on edge, but settled down. They're crashing into the end board. Daniel Carr trying to make a play there, is unable to do so. Boston regrouping with Dennis Seidenberg. The shots on goal 25-18 in favor of Montreal as players gather in front of the Canadian bench.
We're going to get a look at Ryan Spooner's move down the middle. He comes in, and wow, what a quick little shift he puts on the veteran defenseman, the 37-year-old Andre Markov at the blue line. It's just a quick shake of the shoulders, and Markov kind of caught flat-footed. You don't usually see Markov get beat like that, but Spooner, tremendous speed early in the period on the power play. And he just couldn't get enough on the backhand to put his team on the board.
Torrey Krug inside his own blue line. Whips it back into Canadian's ice. Condon ventures out of the crease, paddles it around the wall. Patrice Bergeron for Boston. Backhand pass to the top. Wrister right into the crease, and no worries for Mike Condon.
Alexei Yemelin, an excellent game once again for the Canadiens. He seems to bring his best game when he plays the Montreal Canadiens. Loves to play physical. Won a gold with Russia in the 2012 World Championships. Also a bronze 2007 and a silver in 2010. Represented Russia extremely well in World Championship competition.
Native Kogliati, Russia, four-time member of the team in the World Championships. Played in the Olympics as well. That's Yemelin getting a breather at the bench at the moment. Boston trying to mount an attack here. At the blue line, it's Chara. Slapping it off a leg. Hops on the puck along the boards. Down behind the cage, Louis Erickson. Ventures out, gets it up top. It is Bergeron, one of the one-timer, and that one blocked again. And painfully by Brendan Gallagher. Gallagher just plays that fearless style. It's been fun to watch, bringing so much energy. Such a big part of the identity of this team, isn't he? Just in a nutshell,
so
their
true.
Team. It's Brendan Gallagher, isn't it?
Absolutely. When he is, you hear of, it used to be, you hear of larger players add a couple of inches and a few pounds to everybody, makes them bigger and stronger and tougher. Well, Gallagher just brings more energy to everybody on the ice, his line mates, his teammates. He's the type of player that you're sitting on the bench going, okay, if he can do that, I've got to keep up. And he just forces his teammates to keep up to his pace. And when you play at his pace, good things happen. And he's proven that in his career. He just bullied his way onto the Montreal Canadiens when he started a few years back. And the Montreal Canadiens are just quite happy that he did that. And the rest of his team just follows suit.
A month and a half ago, he fearlessly stepped in front of a Johnny Boychuk slap shot, got his finger mangled, suffered a broken bone. Missed 17 games, returns to the lineup today, and has a goal. Third goal belonged to Brendan Gallagher's 10th of the season. It's deflection in, score! The Boston Bruins on the board. And there it is, the redirection on the point shot. The crowd erupts at Gillette Stadium. It's 3-1 Montreal.
Matt Bolesky in front of the net with the redirect, and they're taking a page out of the Montreal Canadiens playbook. Get the puck down low, force the wingers down away from your defenseman and put the puck back to the point and get the shot from the net. And that's McQuaid with the shot from the point. Just a quick wrist shot, didn't take any time at all. He puts it on net and the redirect in front by Bolesky. You can see Condon following it. Hayes in front with some traffic, but Condon sees that the whole way. Nice hand eye. Matt Bolesky just redirects that puck, a little bounce shot and into the net. And this crowd is now into this game.
Injecting some energy into Gillette Stadium. Matt Bolesky's 8th of the season. McQuaid will get the assist. So the Bruins say finally, one of those point shots finds its way in. You can hear the decibel level pick up. And now it's a 2-goal lead for Montreal. Seidenberg puts the brakes on behind Tukarask. Fires it off the boards to center edge. He'll get it right back and hand it off for Chara. Frank Petrano, Massachusetts native. Now to Seidenberg, scooped off the boards. Connolly will give chase for Boston. Let's go Bruins, the chant from the majority of fans here at Foxborough. Here comes Thomas Fleischman, with a quiet crowd. Fleischman couldn't tee up. Clean shot at the top of the circle, and it's back to the Canadiens' defense. Oleski from McQuaid and Spooner. Official scoring on the goal, 3:56.
Well, that's good. A 4-point point streak going. Got 4 goals in 4 games, 5 points in those 4 games. He is really starting to get comfortable with the Boston Bruins. Had a career year last year, 22 goals in Anaheim, and he has got his team back into this game in the third period.
The official attendance for the day, 67,246 at Gillette Stadium. And we pulled in, what time was it? About 9 a.m., Dave, and the tailgaters were out and having a great time, just taking in the atmosphere.
Barbecues were being set up. The tents were all being,
right.
the covers, the setup. An absolutely perfect day for the tailgate in the parking lot, as we've seen from kind of the tradition through the NFL tradition and any afternoon sporting event in the United States. The tailgate parties get going very early. Lots of open flames, lots of food being barbecued up, and I'm sure it was breakfast at that time. Everybody getting ready for the big event.
Want to hop off the bus and just join in.
Yeah, we would have.
Yeah, good time.
Had to step over one open fire. It was lots of fun surrounding this event. Now this crowd's into it as the Boston Bruins home team's got a goal. And they're down by two, and that's the lead, the worst lead in hockey, everybody says. But the Bruins have put themselves right back in this game with that goal.
Here comes Brendan Gallagher. Gallagher looking to pull the trigger on a shot from the dot. Parham's back to Petrie. Flings it down low off the glass. Top shot by Plekanec. Thomas Plekanec now. Or Max Pacioretty. The captain slides it back to the blue line. Petrie across, gets the return feed. Has some space here. Wines fires a shot. Goes off a stick and well wide. Back to Adam McQuaid, who gets the primary assist on the goal from Matt Pileski. Redirection by Louis Erickson. In the Canadian zone as Condon looks on. Mark Barbario snaps a pass that misses everybody in a white jersey. They're going to have an offside call against the Canadians. A face-off in the neutral zone.
Young Daniel Carr, playing in his 13th game, signed as a free agent out of Union College by the Montreal Canadiens.
Looks like he went with the eye black, but it's fading on him.
It's starting to fade now.
Some of the guys like Mike Condon, it looked like kind of going with the stickers as opposed to the traditional eye black. And you saw it there wearing off on Daniel Carr.
Just takes a little bit of the glare away if there was any sun, and now with the lights, just take some of that glare away.
Here comes Joe Morrow in, fires a shot, and that one misses upstairs. We're gonna step aside with 13:53 to go, third period. Boston is on the board. It's 3-1. In Foxborough, Canadians leading it 3-1 is the score in the third period. A look at Frank Vatrano, Massachusetts native. Number 72 for the Boston Bruins. His brother Sammy lives and works in Singapore. And he was saying yesterday, his brother immediately, as soon as he got called up to the National Hockey League, booked a trip home from Singapore to be with the family for the holidays. And then sure enough, Frank has played so well that he has stayed at the NHL level and is able to play in this game. So his brother Sammy, all the way from Singapore, here at Foxborough, along with several other family members. I think he said 22 tickets that he had to buy for friends and family.
So he's playing for free is what you call
he
that
probably
today.
Is,
he
yeah.
can just hand the paycheck for today back in and say thanks very much.
22
just
will do it.
Toward yeah. tickets
to in this event.
Interesting. He played on the Boston Junior Bruins in the EJHL, which is a junior hockey league in the area. And now he played his college hockey at UMass Amherst in a short time with the U.S. National Team Development Program a couple of years there. And now he is playing for his hometown Boston Bruins in probably the biggest, definitely the biggest game of his life up to this point.
Ronaldo aggressively on the forecheck in the corner, but the Canadians will ice it here. With Dennis Seidenberg coasting back the puck to the end goal line.
Thomas Fleischmann having a fantastic year with the Montreal Canadiens. It's nice to see players come to other organizations, and Fleischmann came in and he started with Washington. He kind of bounced around Colorado, Florida, and Anaheim, and then he came to Montreal and he was put in a perfect role as a third line player, and all of a sudden his skills start to show. He's an excellent skater.
Off the face-off, quick shot, stop, rebound, digging forward, chopped up by Connolly, save made again, huge scramble forward in the crease, and finally the whistle sounds. Ronaldo in there. Brett Connolly is right in the crease. Now on the seat of his pants, Condon will slowly make his way back up as the dust settles there. What a scrum that was.
Big time scrum. And the reason it became a scrum was because the puck popped out in behind Mike Condon. And PK Subban is down, still on the ice. And he's in some pain. But watch as this play develops. Quick shot off the faceoff. Watch where the puck lands on Condon. It slides underneath. It hits his stick. It hits the stick, and there's Ronaldo. And he couldn't get his stick free to get to that loose puck. And from there, it's just absolute mayhem. You see, Ronaldo kind of gives Subban a face wash on the way down in that scrum, but watch the puck hit the stick of Condon. As it hits the loose the stick of Condon, and Ronaldo was centimeters away, if not millimeters away, from putting that puck in the open net, making it a one-goal game.
PK Subban okay, and back at the bench. Sneaky little play there from Zach Rinaldo right to the face of PK Subban as he was down, had Brett Connolly on top of him.
Hey, it's not comfortable when you get a glove raked across your eyes or your face. It's whether you're indoors or outdoors. But Zach Rinaldo giving a little face wash and pulling the helmet of PK Subban.
Here comes the rush for Boston. Erickson in front for Bergeron. A tip on goal. It was fought off by Condon. Trickles out the center ice. Jumped on by Torrey Krug. Krug for McQuaid. He's got the red line. He'll snap it in around the boards. Or did he not have the red line? The linesman saying he did not. It'll be an icing call, albeit a very close one. Icing will bring the faceoff back into the Bruins zone.
Excellent rush. This is Bergeron. Starts the rush through the neutral zone and moves it to his left side. Louis Erickson retrieves the puck and just hesitates for a split second and allows his teammate to get to the front of the net, and just that nice little saucer pass into the area on top of the crease, and Patrice Bergeron just not able to redirect it home, but nice rush and nice offensive chance by the Boston Bruins.
Good speed here from Torrey Krug. To the right side for Bergeron. Snapped on goal. Save made, and it just trickles wide of the post back towards the front by Ferraro. And cleared away by the Canadiens. The puck wobbles back into the Bruins zone. Another close call. Boston that close to making it a one-goal game. Montreal now trying to answer with Galchenyuk. Dancing along the far board. Hopped on by Carr for Galchenyuk. Galchenyuk now grabbing at the half board to protect the puck nicely. Now it's Kevin Miller recovering for Boston. And the Canadiens make a change behind the play. Rushing ahead will be Joe Morrow. Morrow rubbed out along the near side of the back to his defensive post. And Mark Barbario over the far wing. Chipped out the center ice. Good cut off by Dennis Seidenberg. And now it's Spooner. He will pitchfork it in. Stopped by Yemelin. Sidestepping a check is Brian Flynn, number 32.
Well, you get a Bolesky goal, you get a couple of scoring opportunities, you get the crowd back in the game, and now all of a sudden the Boston Bruins are showing some life. Montreal Canadiens maybe a little guilty of sitting back in that neutral zone, allowing the Bruins to get the speed through the neutral zone, which has really helped them generating some scoring chances. But either way, the Boston Bruins are pushing for more.
Seidenberg looking to lead Connolly into the zone. Back to the top for Chara, banged off the wall. Back into a three-man tie-up with Connolly in the middle for Boston. Stealing it, moving it ahead is Brendan Gallagher. Wants a step, lobs it all the way across. Shot, score, Pacioretty! On the two-on-one, Max Pacioretty has answered for Montreal. They reclaim a three-goal lead.
Well, we were talking about Frank Vatrano earlier, and this is just a tough break for the young Boston Bruin forward. Zdeno Chara pinches down. Watch Vatrano in the middle. He's right with Pacioretty, and he just toe picks. He goes down, and as soon as he drops, the pass is made from Gallagher to Pacioretty, and that unfortunate stumble by Frank Vatrano just allowed Pacioretty the extra space and the extra time to retrieve that puck. This is a two-on-two situation. The Bruins are in no trouble. Beautiful little saucer pass. But Vatrano, you can see he goes by the net with his head down. He just toe picks on the ice at the blue line. Pacioretty gets the extra space and makes no mistake retrieving that pass from his teammate, Brendan Gallagher. And much like we saw earlier, it was Pacioretty to Gallagher. That one was Gallagher to Pacioretty, and the Montreal's top line with Thomas Plekanec also getting an assist on the play. His second assist of the game has given the Montreal Canadiens their three-goal lead back.
Thomas Plekanec two assists as well. And Max Pacioretty with his 16th goal of the season. The Canadiens make it 4-1. Montreal looking to add to the lead. It's tipped on goal. Duke Rask diving across. Punch that one aside. Max Talbot on the tie up there. Talbot and Krug working in the trenches. You have a penalty coming up though. A little bit too much of a hold, it looks like. And now some shoves after the whistle. After Raskin made the save, players get together, and it is going to be a holding call. The Bruins are going to be shorthanded.
Bruins have to be careful they don't receive another penalty in this situation. But we're going to go back and look at Patrice Bergeron's opportunity. He takes a high shot on Mike Connan. Connan takes it with the shoulder. He thinks he's redirected it well over the net. That almost goes in. That was a great scoring opportunity. And then shortly after, the Montreal Canadiens come back down. That could have been a 3-2 game if Bergeron's puck is about maybe 2 inches to the right and rolls in the net. Instead, it rolls to the outside of the post, and within about 90 seconds, the Montreal Canadiens regain that 3-goal lead on Pacioretty's goal.
Max Talbot involved with his 4th Winter Classic, playing in his 3rd. He gets his 2nd penalty of the day. He goes off for holding at 9:24. Montreal with a huge chance here, but the whistle sounding, have to reset the net.
And after that goal, you can see the Canadians, you talk about momentum swings, and you see the Canadians with a little extra jump in their step. Ball is down deep, and on the next shift, they're dominating the play down low. They draw the penalty. The momentum has shifted back to the Montreal Canadiens after Pacioretty's goal, whereas before, since Bolesky's goal, the Boston Bruins had really controlled play.
We'll reset the pegs right behind Tuukka Rask. The Canadiens, after such a dismal month of December, so many struggles, completely looked lost at times. And now Brendan Gallagher has returned to the lineup and has sparked this team and also the atmosphere. And you wonder if this is exactly what the Canadians needed, this event. And then, oh, by the way, there's a guy named Carey Price who's on the way back to the crease, too.
And when Carey Price gets back, look out NHL. But I'll tell you, playing Brendan Gallagher with a veteran player like Thomas Plekanec, what a great leadership figure Thomas Plekanec is for the young Brendan Gallagher.
Canis with 2 assists on the day, native of Kladno of the Czech Republic. 8 world championships for Team Czech Republic for Thomas Plekanec. He winds it up to center ice right now. Flips it over to the far side, and they'll spread out on the power play team.
Plekanec just does everything well. Power plays, penalty kills, faceoffs. Consistently scores goals. And consistently puts points up for the Montreal Canadiens, and a true leader of the Canadiens.
Subban catches the pass. Slides it over to the left side for Markov. It is Subban. Back skates. Hand off to Plekanec. Pumps it right in front. Never got through to Rask. Comes back to Plekanec. Now to Subban. Plekanec, a one-time drive, is fought off by Rask. Made the save up high. Appears stunned for a second.
Yeah, he's hurt. He caught this under the mask. I think this was redirected. He's thrown his mask down. The shot by Plekanec looked like it was redirected, possibly like Gallagher in front. And that shot may have come up and got right up underneath the mask of Tuukka Rask. You can see he's got it right in here under the chin. There are very few open areas in goaltender's equipment, and that is one. We'll get a real good look at it here. There's Gallagher again. I'm not sure if he touches it or not. Difficult to tell, but either way, that comes right up on the chin and the cheek of Tuukka Rask. He immediately took the helmet off. And like I said, there are very few open areas, and the open areas are right down underneath the jaw of the goaltenders.
And
see Max Pacioretty, he bumps into the camera. You can see the camera, and he's not very happy. Then he walks over and he slaps the glass. I'm not sure if it was a camera or what. I think he's upset with the cameraman. The cameraman had the camera sticking through the hole, and it whacked Max Pacioretty. And hey, everybody's got to do their job, Max. Sorry about that, but he hit him in a vulnerable spot as he got caught on the wrist. I'm laughing because the amount of times that would happen for a player like Max Pacioretty, and he gets injured. But getting back to Tuukka Rask, looks like he's okay, and he's squirt a little water on that spot. But Tuukka doesn't wear that shield. There was always Patrick Waugh had that bobbling shield below the mask. You see a lot of goaltenders have it as a neck protector, and Tuukka Rask doesn't wear it. You can see he's no worse for wear as he's having a discussion with the referees, but I'm not sure if that would have helped him or not. It definitely wouldn't have hurt, but very few open areas on the goaltending equipment, and the puck found it there. When it does hit you in the vulnerable spots, it hurts. Tuukka Rask has had a strong night for the Boston Bruins. He was shelled in the first period when his team was no help to him, and he kept his team in the game. Unfortunately, he just couldn't stop that last Pacioretty shot to make it 4-1.
Pacioretty, as we saw, in some pain on the bench. It's Petrie's drive and puts a dent in the boards. Galchenyuk in the corner, digging for possession. Trickles to some open space. Quaid steps up and will blast it down. The puck's going to go out of play. I think Pacioretty got the wrong guy. As we showed one photographer, and then he went over to the other one, And then he whacked glass there in frustration. And now, in fairness to Max, he had a point because he clearly was hurt. And then the referee skated over there to the photographer and said, you got to push back.
Push it back.
Because your player's going
along. Oh, absolutely.
It is dangerous. He's,
no,
player's moving along the glass, and he bumps into a camera, not expecting something to be sticking out there. It looks like Pacioretty's all right. He's still kind of wincing, though, and he still has both gloves off.
The NHL holds the rights to all the photos, and it's not a Boston Bruins photographer down there. There used to be a guy in Buffalo who would stand behind the boards in the old Buffalo Auditorium, and it was right by the Zamboni door. When the puck came around, he kicked the boards, and the puck would pop right in front of the visitor's net for two periods. So you could say there's a hometown advantage. But Pacioretty in this situation, this wasn't a hometown photographer for the Bruins. But no question, you're skating along, and you get whacked by something sticking out of the boards. You don't expect it. Not only will it surprise you, but it obviously hurts as Max Pacioretty is readjusting his elbow pads.
Watching those two replays, he had the wrong guy. We'll have to clarify that after the game. Clearly, he's still not happy about it. Power play chance continues here for Montreal. Going to add to their lead. They've just scored a huge goal from Max Pacioretty at 8:49 to make it 4-1 and really quiet this stadium.
What happens if Pacioretty got hurt there and he's out for any length of time? He was injured by a slash from the camera. You don't see that happen that often. It's like a puck going through those holes. Unfortunate situation, but one of those weird moments in sporting events that you don't see.
Jeff Peachy slowly in his own zone. The penalty has expired. Max Talbot out of the box and onto the ice right now. Some scrambled play along the far side. The puck settled by Seidenberg. Flings it over to the neutral zone, deflected by Ronaldo into Condon, and he'll put the clamp on it with 8:13 remaining in the third period. And 4-1 the score, Montreal with Desharnais, Byron, Gallagher, and Pacioretty in the goal column. Max Pacioretty, the captain of the Montreal Canadiens, looking to be okay after running into a camera lens, which is not something I expected to say here today at the Winter Classic, but he looks to be okay on the bench after favoring his wrist or hand.
Now, Max Pacioretty and the Boston Bruins have a little bit of a history. Zdeno Chara took Max Pacioretty hard into the boards in Montreal, and it was a serious injury for Max Pacioretty that put him out for a lengthy period of time. Actually changed the rules of the game, and you can see the glasses rounded now at the end of the benches, and that was one of the changes that brought about these rounded edges instead of a square cornered edge that Zdeno Chara took Max Pacioretty into when he was injured. So Max Pacioretty and the Boston Bruins, whether it's cameraman or glass or opposition, doesn't seem to get along too well. But he's quite happy he got that fourth goal to give his team a three-goal lead once again. It was actually in 2011 when Chara took Pacioretty into the glass in Montreal.
A scary moment. Max was carted off the ice on a stretcher. And wondered about the future for Max Pacioretty, and since that incident, he has really taken off, become one of the top goal scorers in the world. Pacioretty with 16 now on the year, and a huge response goal by the captain of the Canadiens. Shot from the outside, sails wide, back to Chara, booming shot, and Condon the save there. All kinds of traffic in front, and some sticks get up again.
A little frustration. Hayes has had a very good game. Jimmy Hayes has been in the middle of a lot of things in today's game for the Boston Bruins. He was in front of Mike Condon in the only goal that the Bruins scored, creating a distraction. He's been good on the forecheck. He's had some shots. He's a big guy. And when he's given a little bit of space, he can do some damage. And he's had a very effective game. One of a few forwards for the Boston Bruins, actually, in today's game that's been effective. He and Bleski have been pretty good.
And Hayes coming off his first career hat trick in their most recent game prior to this one against the Ottawa Senators. Mentioned the fourth line, which was so good in that one. Max Talbot, Jimmy Hayes, Zach Ronaldo. And a dominant win, putting up seven on the board against the Ottawa Senators. That was on Tuesday. This puck over to the corner. And Mike Condon looking on. He's been fantastic. 26 saves. That one, he gets credit for one. Very routine. Petrie has stumbled around a Beaulieu, and it's off the boards. Boston has to tag up the blue line. PK Subban looks at his options. He likes to go to Thomas Fleischmann. Redirects it down to the Boston zone. 6.5 to go, third period. 67,000 plus in attendance here at Gillette Stadium. Many of the Bruins fans, many disappointed to this point. Erickson going to Joe Morrow. He's there. He shoots, and Condon makes the save.
Nice play by Joe Morrow to get up involved in the offense. And when you're down by three late in the third, that's what you have to do. If you give up another one, no big deal. Mike Condon with a nice stop. Watch Morrow on the back end. He just starts to creep in. He's got a stick up looking for a possible one-timer, but three Bruins are down low going to the net. You don't normally see your defenseman in that low, but Morrow, realizing the situation, the score of the game, steps up and gets himself a pretty good shot, pretty good scoring opportunity. Mike Condon, once again, is there to make the stop.
Patrice Bergeron's going to be tossed out of this faceoff here. One of the best in the business. Louis Erickson and Landon Ferraro completing this trio. I wonder if Landon's dad, Ray, is watching this game. He's in Helsinki.
I'm sure somehow Ray will be watching this game. I'm sure he doesn't miss too many, especially the bigger games for his son Landon, who's really found a good fit here in the Boston Bruins. I don't think the Detroit Red Wings really wanted to lose Landon Ferraro. They were probably hoping he'd clear waivers, but that was a fantastic pickup by Don Sweeney and the Boston Bruins. It's been a nice fit. He can play in all situations. Excellent speed, energy player, much like his father. His dad had a little better touch around the net, but had the same energy that Landon brings to the game.
Landon's dad, Ray, broadcasting CSN in Helsinki, the World Junior Championship, former NHL Ray Ferraro. Might be tuned into this broadcast. If so, hello to Ray Ferraro. Pacioretty's over the line and offside. We did get confirmation it was the wrong photographer that Max Pacioretty was angry at. Dave Sanford over there, he's a veteran. He's not going to stick that camera lens out into the play. We'll be back.
Condon's got to be extremely excited. He's going through his little routines goaltenders will do in stoppages of play. And right now, I'm sure he is looking up at that clock wondering, is it stopping or is it moving? It couldn't go fast enough right now for Mike Condon. Even though he's got a three-goal lead, he's got to be extremely excited. You talk about a great story. Here's a young goaltender playing the East Coast Hockey League, then the American Hockey League, one step up, and then now to the National Hockey League, played, you know, for a goaltender to come up and play at the level that he's played at in such a short period of time is really outstanding. And now to get this opportunity to play in the Winter Classic in your hometown for the arch-rivaled Montreal Canadiens in front of family and friends and have an outstanding game so far with 27 stops and 28 shots. It's just got to be a dream come true so far for Mike Condon. What a great holiday memory.
You start thinking the stars of the game, he's got to be in the mix. And a tremendous story. You mentioned some of the time in the ECHL, rode the buses. He paid his dues and gets this chance due to the Carey Price injury. But coming into the season, many people didn't even know who Mike Condon was. Dustin Tokarski was going to be the backup to Carey Price. And Mike Condon earned the spot, won the job as the backup in training camp. And then you have the injury issues for Price, and all of a sudden, Mike Condon becoming a household hockey name.
And it's amazing how you never know who's watching. So you've got to make sure that when you're playing, play your best, because there's always someone watching. And how you get your opportunity is how you perform in past games. And it's what you do with your opportunity that can really dictate your career. And Mike Condon's done a very nice job with his opportunity with the Montreal Canadiens.
Sucked in front by Byron, and the net's been dislodged. His players crashed into the far post there. Down to 4:51 to go in the third period, and several of the fans have headed to the exits. Attending 67,246, far fewer remaining now. Going to beat the traffic and the cold.
Alex Galchenyuk, no question that the Canadians have done what they wanted to do by getting the crowd to go home halfway through the third period. Alex Galchenyuk tried to pass it. Kind of one of the situations where Galchenyuk has got to get used to shooting the puck, as he drove the middle of the net, middle of the ice on a 3-on-2 situation. And I'm sure that his head coach and his general manager would love to see him put that puck on the net. He's such a great passer and looks to pass sometimes too often in a situation like that. Just put the puck to the net. If it doesn't go in, play off of the rebound. But sometimes it's tough to get a skilled player like Galchenyuk to think shoot rather than pass.
Well, Galchenyuk's going to be watching Team USA at the World Juniors tomorrow, taking on the Czech Republic. Alex Galchenyuk won a gold medal with the United States at the World Juniors 2013. As we mentioned, Russian descent, and did spend some time living in Russia, but was born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, when his dad was playing in the IHL there in Milwaukee. So Galchenyuk played for Team USA. This team here today leading comfortably as Joe Morrow breezes in. Smooth skating defenseman. Morrow backhands it down the wall. Doesn't find a teammate. It's tucked right in front, and Vetrano poked at it. Omni made the save, and Subban takes over behind the goal.
Would it be nice to see Vetrano get that goal if he was able to bang that in after getting scored on while he's on the ice in that stumble on Max Pacioretty's fourth goal.
Canis will throw it back. It is Subban. Hoist it up over some bodies. Corey Krug punches it back to center. And Max Pacioretty will give it back to his defense.
I think this game, Steve, really shows you the depth of the Boston Bruins. And I say that because David Krejci is out of the lineup. He's a huge part of this offense, having a tremendous year. Brad Marchand is out with a three-game suspension. Another player is having a huge offensive year, and they just don't have the depth to replace those offensive players. Now, most teams may not have depth to replace offensive players like that, but the Bruins, you know, really struggling. When you're bringing in the young guys like Vetrano to replace some of your top players, the Kochev with little NHL experience, it's very difficult to win in the National Hockey League when you're developing players in the National League instead of in the American League. That's what the Bruins are forced to do in this situation.
Especially at the center position, too, isn't it? Chris Kelly is not playing. Yunus Kemppainen is out of the lineup. And then you throw Krejci in there, and we know what he can do, as you talked about. So at an important position and a position of strength for the Boston Bruins, some major absences down the middle for this team.
And when you're relied upon to win the faceoff, such as the Krejcis do and Bergeron's do, and you have the puck after those faceoff wins, that's even a bigger loss, because now you're chasing more of the game rather than controlling the game. We have puck, and Ryan Spooner's done a good job, and the Bruins have done a nice job with Ryan Spooner developing him, and this is his first full season with the Boston Bruins, and he's being pushed into a higher position other than a third line center, and he's an offensive player, but he's not at that level of the David Krejcis as of yet. And in this game you can see it. The Montreal Canadiens, they've been quicker, they've been better all game, but there's been really no pushback, no offensive push from the Boston Bruins. And they did definitely miss players such as Marchand and Krejci.
Brad Marchand, the three-game suspension for the low hit on Mark Borowiecki of the Ottawa Senators in Tuesday's game. Turnaround shot there from Carr. Is off a leg and wide, and we're down to 2:05 remaining in the Bridgestone NHL Winter Classic on what has been really a perfect day. Perfect hockey day, unless you're a Bruins fan, of course. But weather-wise, not have been more perfect for the conditions. We were wondering about the sun creeping in, causing some problems, and never really happened. Perfect overcast day for hockey, and the temperature, I would call it pleasant.
January 1st.
Behind the goal here, look out. Lars Eller and Jimmy Hayes. Bear hugging each other right now. We get some punches thrown here. Yes, we are. Jimmy Hayes getting a few rights in there, sneaking in on Lars Eller. And a couple more. Switching over with the lefts.
Well, Lars Eller, I cannot recall, and I've seen a lot of Bruins games, I cannot recall the last time Lars Eller got in a fight and dropped the gloves. You could see originally it was as though they were just going to hold on, but Jimmy Hayes able to get free, and Lars Eller realizing, yeah, I don't need any part of this. But Lars Eller is a competitor. He's going to get in the ugly areas. Probably not very happy with the hit from Bolesky, not happy with the hit from Hayes. But he comes right back. He stays right in the play. And at the end of the shift, Hayes, a little frustration probably for Hayes, more in the way the game's gone than necessarily the way that Lars Eller has played. They will miss the handshakes at the end of the game as they both be escorted off to their locker rooms.
Well, we'll see if the handshakes take place. If we know with the history of the Winter Classic, we've seen it some instances and then others, as famously documented on the Road to the Winter Classic 24/7 Penguins Capitals. I think the Caps were willing, and the Penguins skated off the ice. And Bruce Boudreau said something to the effect of, oh, who cares? That's paraphrasing.
I think we'll see the handshake. I think that's part of the game. Yeah, these guys are competitors, and it's a great rivalry, but that's all part of it. That's just the respect.
Shot off the post, follow-up score. It's a second goal for Paul Byron. He's got two in the Winter Classic, and the Canadiens punctuate this game. 5-1 is the score.
Tuukka Rask sent this puck flying over the glass afterward in disgust from this goal. All starts, this is a face-off win for the Boston Bruins, but they're just not able to retrieve the puck as it gets put back to the boards. And once again, the Canadiens' offense from their defense. The shot from the point hits the post, and there is Byron as the puck bounces straight to him. He reads this play. He's following the shot to the net, and he follows it up and takes it, and then here's Tuukka Rask's reaction. He punts this over the glass. Oh. Not very happy.
There's your field goal.
He does have the punter from the New England Patriots. For the kicker, Steven Gostkowski picked
right
him on his mask, but total frustration there by Tuukka Rask. And he's played a solid game. You really can't say one of those goals was a weak goal. He's played very well for his team.
25 saves on the day, but Paul Byron gets that one past him on the rebound. His seventh goal of the season, so Byron with a pair. Bergeron shot cracks off the glass. And we're down to a minute to go as the fans head to the exits here. Connolly just missing on a one-time attempt in front. Hard check on the near boards by Fleischman. Toss toward traffic by Bergeron. Stuff attempt. Condon keeps it out again.
Krug's going to go right back at Fleischman. Not happy with that hit. Fleischman took Krug into the boards kind of from behind. And after the whistle, Krug got up, went right at Fleischman. And I'm sure he's letting him know that he doesn't appreciate the little extra shove from behind. Fleischman a little bigger than Torrey Krug.
Still barking away there is Thomas
Fleischman.
Oh, they'll
keep going, and they'll be sitting on the bench. They'll still be going at each other. They won't be able to hear each other, but they're still going to be going at each other.
Thomas Fleischman from the Czech Republic, Olympian, two-time member of the World Championship team with the Czechs. 620 NHL games, had a solid career.
Fantastic career. It all started when he came to North America with the Moose Jaw Warriors. And he actually won a Calder Cup, which is the American Hockey League Championship with the Hershey Bears in 2006.
Time winding down here on this fantastic day in Foxborough, Massachusetts. New Year's Day and a celebration of the game. Dennis Seidenberg wraps it around the dasher. Montreal getting a goal very early from David Desharnais, setting the tone. The energy of Brendan Gallagher coming back into the lineup, the great goaltending from Mike Condon, the save in the final second of the second period will always stand out as one of the best. You put that right up there with any save we've seen in Winter Classic history.
Oh, I agree. Absolutely. Maybe even this season, that was an absolutely outstanding glove save.
That'll do it from Foxborough. The final score, 5-1. We're not done yet. Sticks go down. Lynn, as well as Paul Byron in there. Some barking continues. We've got great rivals. It looks like cooler heads will prevail. Mike Condon will finish this one with 27 saves. He grew up as a Patriots fan, about 20, 30 minutes away from Gillette Stadium. Massachusetts native, plenty of friends and family in attendance. And he has just won the Winter Classic for the Montreal Canadiens as he's congratulated now by his teammates. And rightfully so, that spectacular save on Ryan Spooner at the end of the second. And 5-1 is the final score on a picturesque winter day here in Foxborough.
Well, congratulations to the Montreal Canadiens. Well-deserved win, Mike Condon. And you guaranteed everybody on his team knows how important coming and playing in this game in his hometown, close to his parents and family. How important it was for Mike Condon to have a big game. He did that. His team was outstanding in the first period, scoring a minute and 14 in, dominating the first period and really setting the tone for the rest of the game. And then the second and third, Mike Condon coming up big and guiding his team to the win as both teams acknowledge the crowd.
But no handshake
on this day.
It looked like they were possibly thinking about it, and they were staring at each other, and then it never happened. Can't say I'm that surprised. But we've seen the handshake line before in some Winter Classics and some we haven't. And we know the history between these two. They're not exactly cordial.
I'm a little surprised.
Really?
I'm a little surprised. Usually the handshake is bigger than the game itself, and there wasn't enough in this game to really, you know, have a pushback and say we shouldn't have done it. But you know, this is a... This is what hockey's all about, playing outside. This is where a lot of these young men started, skating on ponds, skating in the backyard. They put on a tremendous display, and good for the Montreal Canadiens.
Three stars being announced. Matt Bolesky, number three. Mike Condon, number two. Brendan Gallagher returning to the lineup, getting his 10th goal of the season. And it turns out to be a big one. It was late in the second period. He's the number one star and player of the game. Let's take a look at the highlights, looking back on this fantastic day at the Winter Classic.
David Desharnais takes the baseball swing, gets a piece of it in the football stadium. And that's the first game. 74 seconds into the contest, the ice was still shining. And it's 1-0 Montreal. And that's all that we saw in the first period. Dominance by Montreal, but not on the score sheet. Paul Byron with his first of two to start the second period. And then more baseball-esque or lacrosse-esque plays. Patch ready out of the air to Gallagher out of the air. Broken finger and all. It's obviously healed as they get one of the prettiest goals of the season. 17 games away from the game due to injury. Brendan Gallagher comes back and scores. And then at the end of the first period, Ryan Spooner with about 0.1 second left on the clock. Mike Condon throws the glove up to keep it at 3-0 after two. Matt Bolesky gets his team on the board. McQuaid with a nice wrist shot, a little redirect in the bounce shot. Big Jimmy Hayes standing all over Mike Condon. And the Bruins are back in the game for a moment. And then it's a toe pick, an unfortunate toe pick by Frank Vetrano. Allows the 2-on-1 to take place, and Pacioretty with a big goal. It regains a 3-goal lead, and then late in the game, Paul Byron off the rebound off the post, and you can see what Tukarask thinks of the game as that puck is kicked over the glass. Teammates celebrate with Mike Condon on a big win, and the Montreal Canadiens start 2016 the way they started the 2015-2016 season. A complete dominance throughout this game.
Now look at the final stats. Shots on goal 30-28 in favor of Montreal. They led in faceoffs and scoring chances. A lot of hits from Boston and the power play opportunities as well. Boston had a couple of key power play chances. One that carried over into the start of the third period, and they were unable to capitalize, so Boston goes 0-for-3 with the man advantage. And Mike Condon is the winning netminder and second star of the game. 27 save effort. As we said, Bolesky at the third star spot, Condon number two, and Brendan Gallagher, number one star and player of the game. And some other notable numbers, Pacioretty with 2 points, Gallagher with two, and Plekanec. So everybody on that number one line with multi-point efforts for the Canadiens. And then you throw in Paul Byron as well, as he had the two goals. This is a lot of fun, Dave.
It was fantastic.
I mean, what a scene this was, and a celebration Beautiful. Of the game in its purest form. Gillette Stadium, everybody, tap of the stick. Both organizations, tremendous show.
Well done. Can't wait for January 1st, 2017.
Where will it be?
Let's do this again.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we'll find out where the next Winter Classic is going to be. Still have the Stadium Series this year. A couple of games, one in Denver, one in Minnesota. And a lot more hockey to be played in this National Hockey League season. An incredible day. And tremendous work by everyone here at Gillette Stadium. For Dave Reed, I'm Steve Mears. Thank you so much for joining us, everyone. Once again, your final score in front of 67,246, 5-1, the Montreal Canadiens over the Boston Bruins. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of the National Hockey League.